Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Resonance Arcade. It is Wednesday night and we are live.
Hello.
We were live a few minutes ago, or 20 minutes ago, when we were all talking. Sorry about that, everybody. At least one person in chat told us that we were already live talking. But anyway, hello to those who are new to the show and those who have seen us before. We haven't been on for about a month because we've all been busy and everyone's been sorting various bits of illness out, etc. But we're back today and we've got quite a lot of stuff to talk about and quite a lot of stuff to show. So those of you who don't know us, we are previously four guys, now three guys from the north of England that talk about games for a couple of hours on a Wednesday night. Lou has decided to leave us. He might be back if I let him back at some point, but he's no longer a permanent fixture. I am speaking to a few other people to see if they maybe want to come on, maybe get some guests on, and if you're interested in being a guest, then get hold of me and we'll see about getting you on the show.
Good firm hold of him.
Good firm hold. And anyway, as a starter, just say hello to a few people in chat that are actually being a bit vocal today. It's probably because we haven't been around for a while. Hello, Bjar. 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 That's one of my old 3D guys from 90 Stone Ninjas. He's, hello, how you doing, Burton? And Biggs. Hello, matey. How you doing? Anyway, so traditionally we start about talk about what games we've been playing. So I seem to have played more than everybody on the planet. But I've been mainly focusing on indie games recently. I have played a few AAAs and a few kind of... There's a few indie games that are like almost getting to the AAA standard that I've played, if you know what I mean. There's one in particular that we've all... Well, me and Steve have been playing as well, so we'll get onto that. But Steve, we'll start off with you, seeing as though you've probably got the least amount played. What have you been up to?
Like I said earlier, I bought quite a few games in the sale over the last weekend. I've only had a chance to play one of them so far, though, which was Sid Meier's Starships.
I saw that in a sale. That wasn't the 2K sale,
yeah,
was it?
It's published by 2K.
Okay, it must have been then, because I saw Starships. Civ 5 was in there, but I've already got Civ 5. And then there was another one that was... The one that you were playing, was it Beyond Earth or not?
Yeah.
Is that what it's called, Beyond Earth?
Yeah, Beyond Earth. That's like the follow-on from Civ 5.
Yeah. But I didn't get it because I thought, you know, Civ takes so much time up and I've got too many other games to play.
Well, this is kind of like, for me anyway, from a strategy point of view, a much cut-down version of Civilization.
Right.
It takes the form in space. You control a fleet. You basically got to not take over planets, but get them to join your faction. And there's other players out there, so you do that by doing missions for them. And also by battling the other players in their planet. If you become successful, you get them to join your faction. And the more planets you control, the more cities you can build, the more raw materials you can accumulate, and the better you can make your fleet.
Can you choose to just beat the planet into submission rather than doing a mission for them?
Not that I know of.
Not that I'm saying, yeah, you should do that, but just as an option, it'd be nice.
If you invade another person's kind of space, then you can attack their planet, which is, like, by extension, attacking their fleet. And if you win, you take over the planet.
So it's online, sort of multiplayer, is it?
There is a multiplayer aspect to it, I think, but it's mainly single player.
Yeah.
There's still like research trees in it. There's limited scope for building up the cities that are on the planet. Aside from that, it's mainly about the like battle strategy, and the battlefield's always a similar sort of setup where you've got a big circle of hexagons, and you've got planets and like asteroid fields which phase in and out of the battlefield. So it's a little bit dynamic.
So you're in space then, obviously, with it being Starships. You're is it a follow-on from...
It's kind of... It's linked in slightly to Beyond Earth. So there's the same factions available, the same characters within the factions.
So it sort of corresponds to the same lore, as it were.
Yeah, it's the same universe.
Yeah.
But really the similarities kind of end there. It's fun. I mean, it's quick. it's nowhere near as long as it takes to like to play a full game of Civ. I only played it on the like normal setting, but I'm in a position now where I can pretty much defeat any one of them, like any of the other players.
Do you think that's its intention, is to be like a slightly more quick fire version that you can play in small doses or something? Is that like the idea behind it?
It seems set up that way because the development of your civilization and your technology tree isn't as long-winded. Like, for example, you can research things just by earning the right material, like the right raw material, which you can specifically build your like cities towards producing.
I just wonder, with a game series like this, I've never played a single Civilization game. I obviously know that it's very well received and it has like quite a pretty big and probably quite loyal fan base. I wonder what would it do a game like this in such a long-standing series? I mean, is it a dumbed-down version? Are they trying to appeal to new people and try to go, we're going to go space sci-fi with it and get a different crowd? Because I would have thought the hardcore Civ gamers are going to be like, this is, it feels a little bit watered down to what I'm used to, doesn't it? I mean,
well, it is watered down, but the hardcore Civ players have still got Civ 5 and Beyond Earth.
It's true. But Beyond Earth's a bit watered down, isn't it, from what you said?
Well, if you go back to when Civ 5 was first released, i.e. the bare bones version of Civ 5, it's lacking quite a lot. It's only when you add all the DLCs on, which allow you to establish trade routes and allow you to build more wonders and set up religions. And it's a DLC that really gives it all the depth. And I think it's going to be the same case with Beyond Earth, because just before Christmas, they released the first DLC, which allows you to use the oceans like part of the terrain. You can build floating cities and you can start mining materials from it. So I think it's going to be the same scenario. And in like two or three DLCs time, it'll probably feel as rich as the other Civilization games have.
Are the DLCs for these reasonably priced? I mean, what do you think, that this is like a slightly dodgy business tactic, or do you think it's just a case of they put out what they've got at the time and then they add to it in a meaningful way afterwards? Or is it like slightly, you know, give me your money kind of DLC?
Yeah, for Civ Beyond Earth, the Rising Tide DLC was $24.99.
Oh, you
know. Yeah.
How much is the game, like the normal retail or the download, I guess, on Steam price of the game?
Well, that's on there for £30 now, but that would have been £40 when it came out.
Still, you're looking at, for now, what it is like now, nearly paying the same again for that DLC. That's quite a lot.
It is a lot.
I didn't get Civ for... Oh, no, actually, I think I did pay full price for Civ 5. Only because we wanted it for a LAN, I think. But
like, it's all relative. So on Civ 5, I've got over 300 hours worth of gameplay.
Well, that's kind of what I'm saying. If it's £24 DLC, that's, like, great. Like, if you go, oh, I'll pay £24 for essentially another, you know, 80 hours of gameplay, then that's pretty reasonable in my opinion. That's kind of what I'm asking.
It doesn't really work like that, though,
does it? Are they good DLCs? Or...
Well, when I got Beyond Earth, I think I played that for about 40 or 50 hours. And then when Rising Tide came out, I got that and I've played it again. Well, I'm still playing it again now and I'm on to about another 40 hours worth. So it gives the game that much depth that all I essentially play with Civilization games are skirmishes. I don't play the preset campaigns, I don't really like them. And the campaigns are just loosely based around the skirmishes anyway. So, like, from that point of view, the DLCs do give you a lot more options and a lot more variety within, like, a versus type of game. So there is a little bit of validity there. I mean, obviously it's a money-making scheme, because back in the old days it just would have been released all as one game.
Yeah, it is a continuous issue, though, isn't it? It's not. It seems like it comes back to this every time, but we can't ignore it. We can't ignore it with these games, even if it's a game that you really like.
I haven't been burned by DLC for a while, though. Usually, when I get DLC, it's either part of some bundle or deal within a sale or something to that effect, or it's stuff that I specifically want and I've purchased because I know it's got good reviews, or I mean, like, I haven't got it yet, but I will probably get the Hearts of Stone DLC for The Witcher 3 if I decide to play that again.
Yeah, I have a vague notion of wanting to get that just because I like the game so much.
But at the same time, I've also kind of finished Witcher 3 and I don't really want to go back to it. So unless it's in some deep... I mean, the amount of times I've got DLC for Skyrim, Morrowind, even lots of, like, plenty of other RPGs, I've got the DLC in a sale and never ever played it. All the Fallout 3 stuff, I got it all ages after I completed the game. But I've never actually went back and played it and completed the Mothership Zeta and all the other stuff. So I haven't seen a lot of the content that they give.
Mothership Zeta, I did play that actually. And it was like, it was not that great, but if you got through Mothership Zeta, you got a cool load of like alien weapons, which are all really powerful. And then you can just take those back into the main game and own everything with them. But the actual DLC itself, you're not missing that much, mate. It was a bit bland. Well, it'd be crazy because you're on a spaceship, but it's not that interesting.
It's not just that. I think the whole DLC thing was an issue a while back for people when we were buying horse armor in Skyrim, you know?
Yeah.
And they were making you purchase something that on PC generally used to be free. You know, the mod scene would create it for free and then give it out for nothing, and they wouldn't charge for it, and the DLC you would get, or the expansions you would get, would be quite a lot of content, and there'd be £30 or 20, 25, £30, and you'd get loads. But now we're talking about microtransactions and things like that, isn't it? It's a bit different.
Yeah, I guess the old school expansions still exist, though. When they do come along, I'm the first one to want to get involved in them. Like the Dark Souls DLC was great. It was a whole new section of the game that was tied into the lore of the main game in a good way, but it was an entirely new section with completely different enemies and environments that had a good few hours worth of gameplay that you could go into, come out of, and carry on with the rest of the game. And that's the kind of DLC, or something like I said before, I really think that the Undead DLC for Dead Dead Redemption was brilliant because it was essentially a new game in that same environment, which is brilliant.
Which I purchased on your recommendation. It's still in the cellophane downstairs. I still haven't opened it. I do really, really want to play it, and especially want to play it because my wife's really, really into zombies, and I really liked Red Dead Redemption. That just made me think that could be our next Friday night game thing. I've got it on PS3, I think.
It's a good game. It has a really good, like... it knows that it's doing a schlocky sort of story, and it has fun with that as well, with John Marston involved in it all. It's like... It's done quite tongue in cheek, but it's not ridiculously over the top silly. Yeah. There's still some scary moments in it, actually, when you're out in the wilderness getting attacked by horrific monsters.
No, I should really play that. I should definitely play that. In fact, while it's in my head, I'm going to make a note on my post-its.
That's the kind of DLC that I like. It's the stuff where it feels like you're getting something new and separate from the game that can tie into the game, but I want a new thing, not like just some bollocks that's tacked on to what's already there, or content that should have been in the game at launch is the one that I really dislike. When they have, you know, on disc stuff that's held off and you have to access it later by buying it, that kind of shit.
Yeah, yeah.
I say on disc because you can download a lot of these things digitally, but what I mean is it's in the original game and is withheld on purpose.
Well, there's that many people who crack games these days and reveal that and leak that kind of information. There was something recently, actually. Which games have we been playing recently? Oh, Metal Gear 5.
There was endings that
should have been included and weren't going to be included until patches, but that wasn't because they were selling it. That's because it would become part of the game after a certain period or when something's happened online with the online community. So, Steve, any other games you played, or is that about it?
That's about it.
Shame. For shame. And Sam?
Okay, so I've gone back to The Witcher 3 briefly, just because I've kind of wanted to finish it off, but I don't have anything more meaningful to say other than that it was kind of... It's one of those games, actually, that because I haven't finished it yet, it was nice to return to it.
Yeah.
Even though I'd sort of... I remembered the controls pretty well, but I had to refresh myself a little bit with them, especially with the casting and the quick select kind of stuff. But that was just, it's just like it felt a little bit a little bit like coming home. You know that kind of feeling with certain games or films, but it sort of feels like you natural. Belong there.
Yeah,
yeah, that was nice. Nothing else really to say about it other than that. I played the recently released remastered version of Resident Evil Zero, which, if you don't know, when the original Resident Evil remake came out on the GameCube, Resident Evil Zero was made like a couple of years later using that same kind of engine, but it was a new story, like a prequel to the original Resident Evil on the GameCube, done in the same style as the Resident Evil remake. So they've remastered that and, you know, released it on all the platforms. And I've downloaded that and played it and finished it because it's Resident Evil and it don't take too long.
I think Awesome Games Done Quick, we're doing a speed run of that recently.
Yeah, I must say, actually, for an old school Resident Evil game, I feel like I'm good at that formula. Like, I can go like that. I know to conserve my ammo. I know to like try and avoid the zombies in certain rooms when I can. You know, like, I know the ways, the tactics. And I played this game on normal, and I found it quite hard and challenging, and died quite a lot. Like, I had to make sure I was saving at regular intervals. I don't normally Resident Evil. I just go like, oh, I can do this, I'm good. But I actually got my ass kicked a little bit in this game. It was quite hard.
I have come to the realise, well, I've finally accepted that I can't be arsed with Resident Evil. I enjoyed the first two, but anything... I mean, Nemesis actually was pretty good as well, but I just can't get back into it. I've lost interest in that particular franchise, and especially, I mean, if the Guillermo del Toro and Kojima thing had happened, PT, that's Silent Hills anyway, isn't it?
Yeah.
That we're getting to a point now where they might actually scare me as well, or they might, you know, there might be too much for my poor little brain. So I'm not into horror games. So I wouldn't
worry about that with the Resident Evil franchise.
No,
mate.
I was just thinking that. I was watching Video Game Nation on TV the other day, and they had a horror game special, and Resident Evil was obviously mentioned quite a lot, and they're talking about how hammy it is and how tongue in cheek it is in a lot of places. And yeah, it isn't as... There's a few genuine scares when you first see them, you know, classical dogs jumping through the windows and the liquor on the ceiling in, I think, is that in 2?
That's in 2, yeah.
Yeah, it's one of the first enemies you see, isn't it? Well, after the zombies, anyway.
Pretty much. It is. It's the first sort of... There's always, like, a standard zombie, and there's always the variations and the monsters.
Yeah.
This game... for anybody who's familiar with the original Resident Evil at all... When you play as Chris Redfield, there's this young police officer woman that you meet called Rebecca Chambers, and she's like your kind of sidekick in that game. So you play as her investigating the area around that mansion in that, but not there, but in like some forest nearby. And you end up getting separated from your team on this old train. You find this this escaped convict guy who they're supposed to have like murdered a bunch of his people that he was in the army with, and you kind of find his backstory out through the game. But it's actually a co-op game, so you have the two characters on screen at the same time, and often you have to split up to do puzzles. Obviously, you know, in the typical thing, he can take more damage, he's stronger at removing objects, she's better with the medicines and chemicals and stuff like that, so they have their own advantages, and you have to look after them both. If one of them dies, it's game over. And you can exchange items between them, and you have to do that to get by in the game. You have to constantly be swapping items between each other, which ends up becoming a little bit of busy work for me. I kind of, even though I didn't mind it in this game because it was handled reasonably well, I find that for any kind of survival horror game or a game that's trying to have that kind of tension, co-op kills that for me. Having somebody there by your side blasting away with you takes away from that feeling of being alone against the monsters, you know? Which is why in the other games, you always have to split up from the person, like Claire and Leon split up right at the beginning, and Jill and Chris split up right at the beginning of the first one. It's kind of like on purpose because you to be alone and isolated. So that, I sort of was okay with that, but it was one of those things that is like the start of the turn away from being horror Resident Evil in general. It was nicely made, but it wasn't as nicely made as the Resident Evil remake. Like, the Resident Evil remake was far more atmospheric and creepy, and it felt like there was more love in the design of that one. You know how, like, you can look up any screenshot and just look at how detailed those backgrounds are, with the dripping of a pipe or like a shadow of a leaf outside a window. And just the way that all was put together, it seemed meticulously constructed. Whereas in this one, it's okay, but there's quite a lot of dingy brown sewer-type rooms and shit like that. These are alternate costumes, I think, in this video. Not that the costumes are that much better in the normal version, but... So yeah, it was a good game. I had a bit of an issue as well with the fact that there were no item boxes. Now, and those of you that have played the original will know that you have these big chests that are like a portal vortex thing that you can put an item in one end of the game, go to a chest at the other end of the game, and that item that you put in that other chest is still there. Hmm. They're like your place to keep your items in. In this game, they've got to abandon that. You just have to leave items and then come back for them later. Which led to a lot of backtracking and fucking around.
That's what I can't be arsed with. The backtracking drives me up the wall.
There was a lot of that. There was a lot of, like, I had to leave the grenade launcher at one point in an earlier section of the game because I just had enough item slots for it, and I had no grenades left, and I was like, well, I'll try and come back for it later. But I couldn't go back for it for, like, another hour of gameplay, by which point I'd found more grenade rounds and I needed it, but it wasn't there, and I couldn't get back because the way was blocked off until I found, like, a sort of shortcut back later. So there's a few missteps like that in it. I mean, it's not a formula that they continued with. They went to the attaché case in Resident Evil 4, and for any other Resident Evil games or whatever, I think they'll have the item box idea again. As you can see from this screenshot here, there's some bits that look really cool, like the fluttering of the environments there looks quite nice. It's quite nice, but there's not as much love, it seems, put into the environments as there was in the RE remake, and it's not quite as polished as an experience to my mind. It felt a little bit like they took that engine and made a game with it with the shittest plot of any Resident Evil game. Not that the plot's great anyway, but the fact that this one's the shittest is kind of saying something.
I'm just thinking that
is it going to attack him?
Is actually totally crap, isn't it?
That scorpion is a bit crap. You fight it at the beginning, and you think it's going to be like really dangerous, and it's just a bit shit.
Is that it?
That's it.
Yeah, he just killed that scorpion with a knife. I shot it with a shotgun because I assumed it was going to fuck me up, but it didn't.
Yeah, so So just remind me then, there's Resident Evil Z. You probably said it, but I was looking for the video, so I wasn't paying too much attention. Is it another game? It's not Resident Evil 1. This definitely isn't Resident Evil 1.
No, it's a prequel. It's set before Resident Evil. You don't go to the mansion in Resident Evil 1 at all.
Okay, so is it...
It was at the time a new experience, a new story, a new game.
When it says remastered, has it been released before?
Yeah, it was on, as I say, it was on the GameCube.
Right.
This is like the same with the Resident... It's weird, because Resident Evil Remake on the GameCube was a remake of a PlayStation 1 game.
Yes, I've got myself, yeah.
They have remastered that remake, as in made it HD, touched up all the graphics and the sound and all that.
Right.
Then released it on, you know, PlayStation, I assume Xbox and PC, you can download it too. The Resident Evil remake was on all platforms, so I bet this one is as well.
Yeah.
Because why not? They might as well. I'd say if you're into like your old school Resident Evil games and you like the Resident Evil remake, give it a go because it's got some good stuff in it. And there's some good challenge to it as well.
Micromanagement in the inventory and.
Yeah, but that's a part and parcel of the old school Resident Evil thing anyway. I didn't mind that.
Yeah, whatever.
It's part of the challenge, you know?
I suppose. I mean, I can't complain. I like having ridiculous amounts of encumbrance and of weight management in, you know, in like the big RPGs, you know, the Fallouts and the Bethesda ones where you're carrying everything on the map.
Yeah.
Start even walking slightly slow.
It's like infinite size pockets where you can carry 12 broadswords and not have them be visible on you at all.
This is definitely the one that I saw awesome games done quick on. I remember some of these areas. The person wasn't playing as this player though. It was a girl he was playing as.
There's Rebecca and Billy, and you have to see, he just set something up in the lift there. Now he's going to swap to Rebecca and she's going to take it and solve a puzzle with it.
Right.
There's some good stuff like that. I like that kind of co-op gameplay where you've got to, like, you split up and go and do things in that regard. I quite like that aspect of it.
Yeah.
I just find that sometimes when they were together, combat with the bosses could sometimes be a fuck-up because you take control of one character and you're like, right, I'm going to blast away. And then the AI companion that you've got, especially if it's Rebecca because she's got no health, it's like getting their ass kicked and doesn't run away. So you take control of them, by which point they're in danger, and you're like, for fuck's sake. Yeah. And you try and run away, and then the other guy gets killed. You know, like, there's that kind of stuff where in the boss fights it didn't work very well. In the puzzle solving, it was a cool idea, It almost felt like you should have been able to leave them out of the room for boss fights and do them one-on-one so that you could just be focused on yourself.
They've still got the like classic loading screens as well, which, I mean, I don't know if they were in Resident Evil Zero, I assume they were, but they're not needed these days, these kind of loading screens. Even though these are small, high-quality environments, you could still probably get away with not having them, but they've left them in there for, I imagine.
I think that was more of a stylistic choice at this point.
Right.
But yeah, that's about all I have to say about that. So, if I'm going to give it a review, I'm saying, like, I give it a fairly soft recommend in terms of it's not the best, it's an enjoyable Resident Evil game with enough issues that it's not up there for me.
That is pretty much what VGN said about it as well. They had a good old review of it, and yeah, they said it's mediocre. If you really want to play Metal, if you really want to play Resident Evil, go back and play the remake of
the remake is better, definitely.
Of this, Okay, so any other games, Sam?
Oh yeah, Metal Gear Solid 5. I don't know if you want to just get into the ending in the story, or do you want to do that later on after you talked about your million games or what?
Right. So we're probably going to spoil Metal Gear Solid 5 now. So I'm going to stick up a bit of text on the screen, just so everybody, if anyone comes on with it, they know that we're going to spoil it. But go on then, Sam. What do you think?
I have to say, the ending of the story and the way it was presented, and also the fact that even after you finish the main story, that's mission 46 out of 50, and the rest of the missions that are left over are play all the missions from earlier on in the game on harder mode, felt like it very, very much ended. Even though it has a big twist ending, it felt like a very damp squib of an ending to me. It felt quite empty and hollow, I have to say. I didn't feel any sense of triumph, resolution, or any of the feelings that I normally associate with the ending of a Metal Gear Solid. And I know I'd said before, I understand this is not a story, isn't as important, the story's not as intricate as it was in other games, really. It felt like I was kind of hoping for a big ending that I didn't get.
So, the ending, if we look at it, the ending of Act 1 was really kind of the ending, wasn't it? Act 2...
You fought Sir Helanthropist, yeah.
Yeah, that was really the ending of the game. Act 2 was very... it felt like filler to an extent. It had some quality story involved in it, but it felt like they'd just thrown a lot... I really, really enjoyed some of the missions, but the extreme missions, I fucked them all off. I haven't completed any of them because I might have completed one, but I just could not be bothered to redo the same mission again with absolutely mental, insane difficulty that was just one shot and you're dead, couldn't be arsed.
The second time you fight Quiet, for example, one shot and dead.
I mean, I managed to... Quiet. Yeah, I mean, if you wear the armor suit and you fight her, you can get two shots and you're dead. But it's still ridiculous, whatever it's called, the tactical armor thingy.
Yeah.
But the ending of Act 1 left it with the whole Liquid. What's his name in this?
Eli.
Left it with the whole...
I'll get on to him.
It left it with him kind of in an ambiguous kind of state, going, right, I've got the virus, what's gonna go on? That didn't really get resolved for me.
It didn't get resolved at all. The whole thing about Eli, there's to my mind, there's a lot of stuff in this game that was brought in, there's characters put in the game that you think, oh shit, that's that character, and they do nothing with them. Like, why the fuck is Ocelot even in this game? Why is he doesn't do anything other than just go, boss, you've got to go over there and get this stuff. And it's like, cheers, Ocelot. You've got none of the intrigue, the duplicity, the even the wankerishness that I kind of liked about him. He's just there being all right.
Yeah, he's just there being a sidekick, isn't he? Like,
and he's there. So he's like Ocelot on one shoulder and Kaz on the other.
Yeah, he's like a tutorial, isn't he? Really?
Yeah.
He's there to tell you how to be Big Boss, but, and this is the major spoiler. If guys, and this is I just want to gloat in my and is that the right word? I want to revel in my own magnificence in that I predicted exactly what happened at the end as well. And if you look back on some of these Resonance Arcade videos, you can see, I think we all kind of agreed.
We did.
Me and you anyway. So big spoiler, guys. Really, mute your mouth. Mute your headphones if you don't want to hear it. But mute your mouth. So the fact that the person that you play all the way through the game is not actually Big Boss. You're not Snake. You're not Big Boss. You're Ahab, aren't you?
You're the medic guy who was in the helicopter at the end of Ground Zeroes.
But it's also... I didn't connect that because I have completed Ground Zeroes. I think if you haven't completed Ground Zeroes, then you really haven't got an attention span, have you? But it was more about the fact that they kind of told you about it at the beginning of the game. They redid the scene, which, by the way, how laborious was it having to do that all over again?
Mate, I fucking found it torturous the first time. The second time I was like, yeah, I know. Can we just get to the story point of this now?
So you
I don't want to have to crawl through the hallways for another 10 minutes.
Basically, for those people who haven't played Metal Gear Solid 5 or aren't interested in playing it, at the very beginning of the game, you have to do a bit of a tutorial and a bit of a kind of crawl around and regain your strength while some drugs kick in, and you're crawling around in a hospital and you're getting the tutorial and he's telling you how to do things and stuff. It skips some parts of that on mission 50, is it? Or 46 or whatever 46. It is, 46, which is the end mission. But it does the whole thing again, so you spend... I mean, you can skip through it in maybe 20 minutes, but because you don't want to skip everything because there might be something slightly different, you don't skip it. As a fan, knowing that Kojima always does something quirky or I actually skipped a few of them, and I wish I didn't. But I went back and did it again because I missed some.
Didn't miss anything because he plays exactly the same.
But it does. But he misses some bits out. Anyway, so the end, you find out you're not bloody Big Boss, and you're this Ahab guy, and you've just been kind of conditioned to think that you're Big Boss.
Yes.
So instead, do you jump in a ship and go out and look for whales?
No, you don't find out. Ahab doesn't find out. Ahab still thinks he's Big Boss, but Big Boss appears at the end of the game. And again, more big spoilers. Big Boss appears right at the end of the game and
the real Big Boss
disappears to form his own version of your base. So that leaves it open for more story. It leaves it open for, I don't know, some... Maybe there's going to be some extra conspiracies going on if they decide to continue it, which they will, because apparently they're recruiting for another Metal Gear. But apart from that, that was really the only... And I said it was obvious from the beginning. It was the only real Kojima kind of twist in the entire game, really.
There's always like a betrayal, a cool betrayal in a Metal Gear game, usually.
Thought Kaz was going to do something really wild and crazy, but...
I feel like they had set up, like, the boss and Kaz's relationship in Peace Walker, which you haven't played, but they do set that up quite well in that. And you come into that one, sort of hit it running, but they do it well enough that you can pick up on these two guys, even though you're not playing as him, whatever. The idea that they have a relationship and the trust and all this kind of shit. And, it was throwing Ocelot into the mix. Like, were you not just waiting for him to do something bad, for him to fuck somebody over? Like, because it's what he always does. All the games that Ocelot appears in, he does something duplicitous or fucks somebody over, or he's in. I know there is a conspiracy that he's in on, but there's a conspiracy that he's always playing sides against each other.
But
he wasn't that guy in this game.
But he was loyal to Big Boss throughout, wasn't he?
He was,
but he was looking after your character. So it makes sense why he was there.
Now it kind of does, but Kaz could fill that role too. They both
Kaz couldn't because he had
thing.
One bloody leg. That was it.
He can still talk to you and say, "Do this, do that." And
plus,
the other.
Kaz wasn't necessarily going to be there because you had to rescue him the very first mission, didn't you? He could have died for all you know. So Ocelot was there beforehand. That's a way to argue it, anyway.
Yeah. So, anyway. I mean, I have to admit, it has slightly impaired my overall enjoyment of Metal Gear Solid 5 as an experience. I still think as a game to play and have fun with, it's fucking excellent. Like, it still is excellent fun to play. But as a full workload experience and story as a part of that experience, it's the weakest story wise of any Metal Gear.
Absolutely.
But it has the best gameplay of any Metal Gear. So there's a weird dichotomy like thing going on with it.
It by far surpasses any other stealth game I've ever played, and I include Deus Ex and Dishonored in that. Even though I really, really love those games, there's something in that game, in Metal Gear Solid 5, that makes it very enjoyable, even though you're in quite a small area, small world, that doesn't really have that much going on in it. There's something about the way you approach each settlement, each guard post, that always makes it interesting, even when you're really tooled up towards the end. And I love the fact that you can go back and do it in the subsistence missions where without any tools whatsoever. That makes it really difficult. And
I wish there were more of them.
There was only three, wasn't there? Two
yeah,
or three?
So, yeah.
But yeah, they should have put more of them in. But I still feel like it was rushed towards the end because of the whole Kojima versus Konami thing.
Yes, there's definitely a pacing issue, like really badly. The Metal Gear Solid games, because I feel like 1, 2, 3, and 4 are like that kind of Metal Gear Solid game, and Metal Gear Solid 5 is the new kind, should we say. It's very different. The Metal Gear 1, 2, 3, and 4 kind of have a formula almost. And when you're very used to that formula of you go into a situation, you've got to do the thing and don't get spotted. You do all that shit and it builds up and there's like surprises and there's twists and there's a little bit of character development if you're lucky. And then there's builds to a big fucking emotional ending every time, where like big revelations occur, but there's also and crucially big action sequences and stuff to get through and challenges. There's a chase, there's a boss, there's a boss with a robot, there's a boss with a punch up, and there's some shooting guys being chased on a motorbike or a car or whatever. And there wasn't any of that at the end of this game. It was replay the first mission again and then get the real meaning behind that first mission told to you in a cutscene.
Yeah,
which for an ending to a game like this, it felt like a letdown.
Yeah.
There was no resolution to Eli. You found out that Eli was Liquid, which we all fucking knew anyway.
Yeah.
But they started to build it up that he might be like have some affinity for controlling Sohalanthropus, which, given that he, when he's an older man, will control Metal Gear Rex and fight you in that, is good little foreshadowing.
Yeah.
But they didn't really capitalize on it other than suggesting it. I was like, cool, I want to fight the Sohalanthropus again with Eli in it on fucking Mother Base. And I thought that was going to be the ending.
Yeah, I thought something was going to happen there. So, one other thing that I wasn't sure about, I didn't quite catch it. The third boy was that Psychomantis?
Oh, the boy with the mask on.
Is he called the third boy, isn't he, or something?
Yeah, he is Psychomantis. Yeah. There's an extra op, a side op, where you can go and find out about the body of the man on fire.
Yes, I saw. I did that.
Really,
yeah.
And then once you do that, you get a load of tapes about that.
Oh, and we also called that was Volgin as well, and that actually was Volgin.
Totally so, Volgin. Yeah.
To be fair, there was a lot of prediction. In fact, I would say every prediction came true. The only one that didn't happen was David Hayter being in the game.
Yeah,
and I expected him to be in as the real big boss. Because they could have got him just for that one scene at the end, you know. But the
get you waiting, huh? That would have been so cool. If
it would have been awesome.
Come up and done that.
But what was the fact that what's his name? Fucking,
I don't know.
The guy Kiefer Sutherland. He actually did the big boss voice as well.
Yeah, yeah.
I thought that was a bit they missed the boat there. They really did, because that might have redeemed themselves for a few little bits. You know, that might have went right, because that was another thing I predicted that I was like, okay.
There is something slightly strange to my mind about the long-standing. I know that the Japanese voice actor for Snake Boss or whoever hasn't changed since the original Metal Gear Solid, right? So, in the Japanese version, Kojima or whoever was in charge of what really happened there was fine to keep that guy on board. Like, Kiefer Sutherland apparently did the facial capture for the cutscenes, but even in the fucking cutscenes, he barely speaks. He barely speaks in the game, and it's like, well, it kind of seems like, why bother going to all the trouble of just getting a pretty high profile actor and replacing David Hayter with him in the Western America, the English speaking version, when he fucking doesn't say shit anyway.
He doesn't say much at all, but it's the name that's attached to it, and they did a lot of publicity around that name when it before it came out.
I know, but I kind of get the impression that they were trying to say this is like a almost a kind of reboot, and we're going to go, it is Metal Gear for new people. We're going to get the newbies involved who haven't invested in all the lore. But I just find that, again, you don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. You want to, there's a fucking big group of fans of this franchise who give a shit about it, who know about the ridiculously complicated lore and the characters and the stuff like that, and they don't really want it to have to change. The people were attached to David Hayter. His delivery of Snake's voice is quite cartoony and silly, but it's fucking charming, and it's what I know, and it's what I wanted to hear.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
No, I totally agree, and it is what it is, isn't it?
I feel like I'm really having a go at the game, but I think it's great. I just was a bit disappointed with the story.
Yeah, I mean, as a game, it's wonderful.
It's complaining about it.
It's wonderful. As a Metal Gear fan, I mean, as a hardcore, you know, kind of fundamentalist Metal Gear fan, I'm disappointed, but I don't mind that they've done it either, because if they'd just put a little bit more time into the story, it would have been brilliant. You know, it would have been a 10 out of 10 across the board for every, you know, for sound, music, gameplay, story, you know, environments. Well, maybe not environments, it was a bit bland, but anyway. Shall we move on?
Yeah, that's enough Metal Gear.
Yes, yes. So I shall take the spoiler off, and those who have muted can unmute and get back in. So
that's it for me, so it's your list.
Is that all of your games, sir? Oh, it is. Right, okay, so yes, I've been playing quite a lot of indie games recently, as I said at the beginning of the show, and I'm going to start with the bad, and I'm going to move on to the rest, which are pretty good. I've enjoyed every game that I've played, and each one of them I've put lots of hours into as well. I would say even the latest game that I started playing yesterday, I've put six, no, maybe not yesterday, the day before, I put about 6 hours into it. And all of the games I played are very playable. So I want to start off with one called Cube Director's Cut, which is a puzzle game that is very, very, very much trying to be Portal. But
say that straight away.
I have to say, I got very bored of it. The puzzles at the beginning are very, very easy. I mean, you'll see some of them get done here. I don't know why it's recorded in 4:3, by the way. It's a strange engine they've used, I believe. Anyway, so it's simple things like that. Put boxes and colours, etc. You're supposed to be stuck in a space station, and there's some girl talking to you that keeps coming in and out of your radio, frequency or whatever. And she keeps telling you that you're stuck on a space station, but then there's another guy that keeps telling you that they're lying to you and there's a conspiracy going on, which almost wants me to, like, makes me want to keep playing to see what the end of the game is, to see what the story's about. But I stopped playing it because I got to a point where the puzzles were so arbitrary and nonsense and just annoying, I have to be honest, that I just stopped playing. I mean, these ones are easy. These are, you know, simple, dead easy ones. But there are some later where you have to rotate the room around and using physics. And you know, physics puzzles can, unless they're carefully choreographed, can be quite awkward at times. You have to use physics in order to get coloured balls to go through force fields. And if you mix a blue force field with a red force field, the ball goes purple, and you have to get that through a purple hole. But you have to rotate the room around in four different ways, and it's mind bending. It's just like, I know exactly what I need to do. It's just really difficult to execute. That's the only way I can really put it. This is, I said, it's an indie game. It's been out for quite some time, and this is the director's cut version of it as well that I've got. But yeah, I don't know. I personally wouldn't recommend it. If you want to play a new Portal, go and play that game I played a while back, Talos Principle, because that is wonderful when it comes to puzzle solving.
I have to say, the one thing that standed out to me in this game is how unpleasant that just blocky white background is. Like, it's the same blocky white everywhere.
I don't mind that so much because, again, it's a limited budget indie title, and
I understand
reasons for doing those kind of things. It's the gameplay that, I mean, the principle's good, but some of the puzzles are just like, why? Why have you designed this? I'll try and find one, actually. I think if I've got it, I should be able to sip through. Oh, this is where they introduce the ball. And you have to get the ball to go, hang on. So in between each section as well, as this, so there's girls talking to you, or this other voice that I don't know much about. And some of them are just, you have to line things up and get the ball to go down a ramp, but some of them much more just boring. Anyway, yes. So I said I thought I'd start with the bad.
Sorry, Cube.
I don't like to give too much of a criticism for indie games, because I do have a lot of time for indie games, but I don't know, there's something about it. I don't think
indie games should get a pass because they're indie games. They've got to have some quality, haven't they?
Yeah, no, I mean, there is a quality there if you really, really like puzzle games, but they're a much better... I did just come off the back of playing Talos Principle, though, which is absolutely amazing for story and for puzzles. It's... There's some really awkward, annoying puzzles in it, but you do get them all eventually. I mean, the end of the game, it feels really exhilarating, the Talos Principle. It's a great game to play for the main... I mean, I said it's one of them games that just drives me to complete the puzzles because I want to finish, I want to hear what's going on with all the crazy voices you're hearing all the time and stuff. Okay, so secondly, probably my second least favourite out of the lot, but I actually really still quite enjoyed it, is a game called Her Story, which you probably have heard of. So Her Story is a very different type of indie game, or very different type of game. You're on like an old Windows 95 computer, and you basically get an email at the beginning, or a readme, I think you can see in the background there, readme.txt, and you have to watch videos of a girl getting interviewed. Now, I'm not going to spoil any of it, because part of the fun of the game was, as you watch the videos, lots of things become clear to you, and that is actually part of the being able to complete the game or get to a point where it makes sense to you, is there's certain things that go on within the videos that make you realise things, and there's a lot of like penny drop moments and stuff. It's really interesting if you've got time to just sit and watch videos, and you're willing to search in a database for different names. So say, for example, she mentions, glass or something. You'll type glass into the search terms and you'll find all the videos that mention glass or are tagged with glass. And then that will be relevant based on stuff that she says in those. Some of them are red herrings. And that thing there that you see, that big red thing, is how many of the videos you've watched. So anything that's green is what you've watched. And I've probably watched maybe about 65, 70% of them. But I've completed the game. I figured enough of it out in order to complete it. But yeah, I would recommend it for those, again, if you like a bit of a mystery and a bit of a very different type of game, go for it. Without spoiling it, it's the best thing I can say.
Do you like earn more parts of the more videos and more parts of the story by figuring out the clues and stuff? Is that what it is?
Once you've watched one or two of the key videos, and they're only really short, I mean, I think the longest video is maybe about 4 or 5 minutes that I saw, maybe a bit longer, I'm not sure. Once you've watched a certain set of videos, you get an instant message pop up and it asks you a few questions, and it's just one of your friends in the in the virtual world or in the game world, or one of your colleagues or something, and that also makes you realise some things and the fact that kind of reveals the ending of the story, as long as you've paid attention to what she's been saying in the videos. It's interesting. It's an interesting idea, anyway, at least. Certainly wouldn't appeal to everybody. But I enjoyed it.
I've seen bits of it and I didn't really understand what it was about. Now that you've explained it a bit more... Because I wasn't interested enough to research it myself, because I was like, oh, whatever. But it sounds like it's sort of interesting curiosity, I guess. That's what the way you described it to me. Anyway.
Yeah, I mean, I can't remember where I got it or when I got it. It was only a little while back, but there's lots of little visual clues because you're essentially trying to. You come into the game thinking that you're trying to solve a crime, put it that way. But not everything is what you think it is, and then it all becomes more, a lot more relevant as you play the game, as you watch the videos. That's all it is. It's just watching videos, taking information from the videos and maybe putting a few of them together in sequence and in your brain and going, right, okay, so I need to search for this term and I might get another video. But the video results are only limited to, so you might get 61 entries, but you can only watch the first 5 of them. So you'd have to use multiple words in order to filter out some of the other videos of those entries. It's just searching a database, but it's the story that's the interesting thing, and that's probably why it's called Her Story. Mm. Anyway, yes, so worth a go. So next, another one that's, again, not quite a classical game, but really interesting to me because I'm really interested in games with hacking in at the moment. So there's a game called Hacknet that's come out. What?
You said hacking about 3 times in the same sentence, and I just found it.
Okay, so this game, Hacknet, is essentially you're on a terminal. It's obviously a bit more elaborate than just a command prompt, but it's a command prompt hacking game. So it's interesting to have a go. It's really, really dumbed down, simple versions of programs that allow you to do hacking or allow you to basically query servers. You get jobs. There's a story to it as well. There's a hell of a lot of text in the game to read, and there's no real audio. There's a few audio cues like this has been hacked or this has been opened, or you've got 10 seconds until you're discovered when you're doing your hacking or something like that. But basically you have to scan a computer or scan a node, use different programs to hack different ports on that particular computer. So a computer may have a FTP server, an SMTP server, and a HTTP server, and you might want to hack all of those. You might need to hack all of those in order to get through them. But there's also things like proxies and firewalls you have to get around by using different programs. You can also, once you've hacked certain nodes, so say you've hacked 10 computers, you can use those computers to overload another computer by running shells on them. So all of this stuff's a little bit, I think you have to be a little bit technically minded or a little bit programmer or computer minded in order to get it, but there's enough text there to kind of get you around it. Anyway, so you basically, there's a story to follow, and you end up joining a hacking group of some sort, and then they start giving you jobs to do, and then things are starting to unravel in my game at the moment. There was one really interesting thing that happened is that I was asked to do a special contract, and then after I did the contract, someone hacked my computer, blue screened it, shut it down, not my actual computer within the game, blue screened it, shut it down, and then I had to restore a file from another computer in order to get my computer working again in the game. It's again quite an interesting way of doing hacking, you know. I've always wanted to have a play with a game that did command line hacking. You have to, like, when you've logged onto a computer, every computer is a standard file system, and you have to delete the logs on the file system before you leave because your IP is logged on there until you get, I imagine at some point I'll get some kind of VPN or IP mask thing. It's again quite an interesting concept, and I don't know how much more I'll play of it, but I'm enjoying it so far.
Have you played Hack Evolution?
Nope.
That's a similar sort of thing.
Yeah?
There's loads of different variants of it. I haven't actually played it myself, but I got not a free Steam CD key, but I got a key for it. I've never actually installed it, though.
Right. There's another game that Introversion Software did a while ago that Lou suggested to me a few times. But I said it's quite nice because, you know, you can use CD to change directory, and, you know, you can use various different programs, and you can also kill processes as well on your computer and on their computer. You also have to memory manage, so you've got like 800 meg of memory. I don't know what year this is set in, by the way, but we've got 800 meg of memory. And if you've got, for some reason, if you've got a notepad open, right, notes.exe or whatever it is on this game, it takes like 500 meg up of memory. But if you've got a shell open on 20 computers, you use 200 meg of memory. And it doesn't make sense. And then every time
it sounds like notes.exe has got a memory leak.
Yeah. And every time you try to get into a computer, there's a slightly different way of hacking into it. And each type of game, each type of hack has a different program which takes slightly different parameters and slightly different. So it's kind of easing me into the game, although I'm getting it pretty quickly because it's kind of, I don't hack people, but you know what I mean? It's the kind of stuff that I do every day with command line stuff. And yeah. This here as well that you're seeing now, it's called Point Clicker, and it's a game on one of the servers, and it's just clicking. Just literally clicking. That's all you do to get points. And the job is actually you log onto the server, go into the, someone sent you an email. It's one of the first jobs you do. Someone sent you an email to say, can you go onto the server and delete my save file because I've won the game and I want to win it again. A bit of comedy, you know, and it's daft. So you just go on, find their username.sav file and delete it, and then you're done. But you can download executables as well from computers, and that enhances your tool set and things like that. I think it's quite a novel hacking game, really, but not for everybody. Certainly not for everybody. But I have enjoyed it so far. Okay, so I've been playing that maybe over the last couple of days. See, now I'm struggling to order the rest of them because I've enjoyed all of these a hell of a lot. Game called A Druid's Duel. Have you heard of it?
No.
Let me just make sure the video is playing. All right, so A Druid's Duel is a turn-based strategy game. And it's really simple looking. And you've only got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 types of pieces. To me, it feels more like chess than it does like a game on a computer, if you know what I mean. Because essentially, you've got these little pieces that I'm moving now, which they're the cheapest piece, so they cost 5 mana in order to place. It costs 10 mana to transform your piece into a different type of piece. So you've got all those icons across the bottom. You've got the spear, the bow, the hammer, and the staff. Each one of those is a different piece type, and then you can also place bridges across the world, so every world is floating. And the intention is you have to capture squares, but the other player can capture squares off you as well. But each of your pieces, it takes a while for you to learn them, but each of your pieces has different abilities. So the spear guy can only move one at a time. If you transform him, he can move 4 at a time, but he can't attack. The bow guy can only move 1 at a time, but if you transform him, he can actually he can move anywhere on the map and take over a square, unless it's a special piece. So you can kill someone else. So that guy there just transformed into an eagle and moved over to the other side of the map. If you're the hammer guy, you can move either 2 spaces, or 1 space if you attack, or 3 spaces if you transform, and that costs more mana. So you're constantly managing your mana all the way through the game. And I've become quite addicted to it. I'm playing through the campaign at the moment, and it's one of those games that took me a good while to understand, but I've got to a point where I'm getting really good at it now, and it's hard for me to not lose a match, if you know what I mean. What's it that takes a, I don't know, short time to learn and a long, you know, a lifetime to master type thing. But I said that's why it reminds me of chess, because it's very, very tactical, but it's also fairly... It's, I couldn't beat the first level for ages, and the first level's tiny, and there's no pieces. I just didn't know what I was doing. But as soon as I figured out, oh, so this is like a chess-type game. This is very, very strategic, and, you know, if you've got a piece... if you've got one of your spear pieces next to a caster or a bow, then the bow can't attack you, but you can attack them next turn. But their incentive would be to move away from there. They'd fly away by casting mana, but you've only got a certain amount of mana depending on how many squares that you've got on the board. I'm not doing a very good job of explaining this, but it's quite hard to explain.
I think I understand what you're talking about.
It's really good. It's really, really good. I'm really enjoying it. Yeah, if you get a caster as well, they cost the most to place. They can't attack anyone, but they can remove ground and they can place ground. So they can remove ground from underneath a player and then a piece, and that piece will just fall into oblivion. And that will also mean that the piece of ground that they're on, the opponent will lose, and they will not have as much mana for the next round. So the more ground that you own, the more mana you get per round. There's also things like little fairies around that if you collect them, you get instant mana for that round. And there's also shrines on certain levels that if you capture them and hold the shrines, you get a multiplied amount of mana. So it can become very easy, and it's two player. I think you can actually play against other people. You can actually you can dominate the map, but it's also very easy to just accidentally place your pieces in the wrong place, and you'll just get hammered. So the hammer guys, if you transform, those can move. They can move three spaces, and then you can attack every space. So the incentive there is for them to make sure that. This is actually one of my early games when I didn't realise what the fuck I was doing, so I shouldn't really have moved my caster guy next to that hammer guy. But the caster guy can also turn into a turtle, which makes him almost invincible, but for one round. So yeah, there's loads of little cool things in it, and it's brilliant.
If the transformations, is it the different races or colours that you played as? Because the blue guys are doing different things than the orange guys, or is it just that they're all the same but they just look different depending on what team you're playing as?
They're all the same, and because this is one of my early games, I'm noticing so many problems with the way I'm playing it as well, because I've learned so much. The yellow guy is the AI, the blue guy is me.
I like that bunch.
They're all the same, but if you look in the centre of the map at the moment, that hammer guy is the same as the yellow hammer guy, but there's a few pieces on the board that, for example, I've got three spear guys, a hammer guy, and a caster guy, or warlock, or whatever you want to call them. They're all the same. There is occasionally you'll run across an AI that's got a very special type of caster, and they've got a much wider area that they can cast on, which makes some of the levels particularly difficult to overcome, because you have to approach them or surround them or overwhelm them before you, because they can cast like three times they've got three turns as well that can take, or three moves in a turn, so they can actually kill three of your guys. So you'll need at least four guys or five guys around them in order to actually attack them. But there's loads of different tactics you can use to beat them. So anyway, I'll move on. Witcher in a little bit, but it's brilliant. And if you like strategy games, kind of turn-based, isometric strategy games, it's definitely recommended for me. And I don't think it's very expensive. Don't think it's very expensive at all. Okay, next. Right, let's get this one out of the way. So, you've probably heard of this. I've been playing a game called Life is Strange as well recently.
Yeah,
I've heard about that.
So this is an episodic teenage angst kind of mystery thing. You play as this 17-year-old girl, I think it is. And it feels really weird playing as a 17-year-old girl, I have to be honest. But you've come back to your hometown to go to college because it happens to be one of the best photographic colleges in the world, and that's what you are. You're a photographer, and you've come back to study under this really cool teacher or something. But everything that you do has a... Not everything. A lot of the things that you do in the game make a big difference to how the game plays out, or what happens to certain characters in the game. And, you know, it's becoming quite common that in a lot of games.
But is it actually... Because a lot of the times they say that you have these big effects, but they don't change that much.
It definitely does. And you know what's really interesting about this game, and this is why I'm still playing it, I think I'm on episode 2 at the moment. So what just happened there is a bird flew into the window. But at the very beginning of the game, you have the ability to reverse time. You figure this out. You've got this ability to reverse time. So you could just do something really arbitrary at the beginning of the game. So I've opened the window, and now instead of the bird hitting the window and dying... Oh, I timed it wrong then, so I had to rewind again. But instead of hitting the window and dying, it flies in the room and stays in the room. And then there's a little bing, and it tells you that that action will have consequences. So that little butterfly you see in the top left. The very, very... I play the demo first. I downloaded the demo to have a go of it, to see if it's the kind of game that I'd like playing. And I played it, and at the very beginning of the game, the first thing you do is you save someone's life. You don't know whose life it is you saved at that moment, but you do figure that out eventually in the story. And it's basically someone, you know, someone nearly gets shot in the school. And it's by this crazy guy who has a lot of info. I'm not going to spoil the story, but he's got a lot of influence in the school, and there's a lot of stuff going on. But there's a lot of decisions, and a lot of times that there's so many little simple things that make a big difference. And I think it's I think this is a AAA game, actually. It's not an indie game. This is a Squaresoft game, Square Enix game, I think.
I wouldn't say it's AAA, but it's what do you call, like, a mainstream release?
Yes,
there's a difference in there.
It's a big studio release, then.
Yeah,
it had a budget, put it that way.
It's a nice looking game. Definitely.
It is. It's very nice looking, and you know, it controls well. It took me a little bit. Apparently, it's better if you play it with a pad. It says at the beginning, better played with a pad, but I haven't tried. But it's nice that I am a save scummer, and this game allows you to change your decision based on what happens directly after your decision. So say you stop someone getting hit by a foot, or no, let's say you stop someone bullying somebody at school, and then her reaction is, oh, I didn't need your help, or whatever. This doesn't actually happen, I'm making this up on the fly, but then the next, if say you rewind time and then don't stop them, then they might say to you, oh, you could have helped me, you know? There could be one of them kind of people that's never happy. And it's like, you have to make a decision which one you think is the best for the story or for the character, and then move. It's the same as every other game with any consequences, and if you make a mistake in your choice, I'd just reload it and do the choice that I wanted to make, you know, based on the reaction. So it's nice to have the option built into the game. But there's a lot more to it. I mean, you've got this power because something happens, and you haven't quite figured out what that is yet. But you also keep having visions and having nightmares and dreams. Sorry?
Taking antidepressants.
Yeah, well, this is someone. One thing I have found very funny about this is that everyone's house that you go in, very rarely do they say anything when you're snooping around in their drawers while they're sat in the room with you. It's like you walk in all of the... You live in a dorm because you're at college, and this isn't your dorm, this is your friend's house, but you live in a dorm, but you can just walk into most of the dorm rooms while they're all sat on their beds or on the laptops or something. And the only time that anyone has said anything, it actually comes up with this action will have consequences. It happened once, but every other time you're just going through drawers and logging onto laptops and everything. It's like everyone doesn't care that you're hacking around with their stuff, sniffing the knickers and stuff. It's weird.
Anybody watching is currently in halls or at university. Try that out, see how you get on.
Yes.
See how that works out for you.
You've got, you know, as a typical teenager as well, you've got a phone that you get people so that say thanks for things that you've done to them, and are you around later? Can we go and do something? And There's also a journal where you, every time something happens, you write in typical teenage girl kind of language, going, "Oh, I'm not sure if this was the right thing to do," and you know, it's well written. I have to say, it's well written, and it's not, it doesn't feel annoying either, and I'm quite enjoying it. I think I've got all five episodes, so I'm probably going to complete it. I think
I have to be honest; it's one of those games that's kind of been on my radar. And I've sort of been intrigued, but not interested enough that I've gone out and bought it, I guess.
Well, again, we're in a different situation on PC in that I could go off and, you know, I can get it fairly cheap. So I did, I can't remember, I think it was in the, oh, that's it. I got the demo before the winter sale on Steam, and then I bought this in the Steam winter sale for £5 or something like that, I think.
That's cheap.
For all the episodes, maybe 10, I don't know.
Yeah, I believe they've released like a version of the game where you can just buy like a hard copy of the game and it's just all five episodes now, because they're all out now, aren't they? It essentially was one of those episodic games of last year, so it was, they were done sequentially, weren't they? But you can just buy them all in one package now.
Well, if you remember, we had Mike from I've forgotten the name of the podcast, his podcast anyway. They don't do the podcast anymore, they stopped doing it a while back. Game Over, yeah. Mike from Game Over Yeah came on the show, and one of his co-hosts was playing it at the time, and he was waiting for like episode 3 or something. So it was last year that it was coming out, and there are definitely some characters that you want to punch in this game, though.
Are they? Is it the kind of characters where you want to punch them because they've written them to be that way, or is it just because of like? Is it because they're just badly realised characters?
They've written everything to invoke an emotion from you because you're a teenager in the game. They've written it in a way that hopefully emulates that and makes you want to be one kind of person or another. Now, okay. The girl that you play is naturally quite a nice girl. She doesn't go off and do really horrible things to people or anything like that. But you have I mean, the decisions so far have literally been get involved or don't get involved, you know, sign a petition or don't sign a petition, that kind of thing, you know. And when you, like, say you do something that's slightly morally ambiguous, she'll always comment on it in her head, and she'll always say, well, if I did do that, then this might have happened, or this might have happened. So it's meant to put you in her, obviously, you know, the protagonist's shoes. It's meant to put you in those shoes.
Speaking of that kind of thing, is the voice acting good, then?
Yeah, it's really good. Yeah, you don't...
Because we kind of expect it these days, but if you're playing a game where you've got a lot of inner monologue... She needs to be a good actress, otherwise it's going to be shit. It'll be annoying.
There's the only thing that's annoying about it, as I said, a number of the characters have been written to be absolute bastards, you know? And there's also quite a lot of opinions that she has as the character she is. So you're playing her, you know? You're not playing yourself in her shoes. You're definitely playing that girl. She has a lot of opinions, but those opinions change as things happen in the game. So she might find out that someone she initially thought was a right idiot isn't actually an idiot, and she's just heard through the grapevine that they're an idiot, and she believed them, you know, and that kind of thing, you know.
So does that mean that she has character growth?
She does, yes, and I don't think that's necessarily based on the decisions you make.
But that's often an elusive thing for video game protagonists, is to have character growth.
But she's also young, so there should always be growth. So that's why I think it's quite well written, if you know what I mean, because it is interesting. It's definitely interesting. There's a lot of walking around, looking at things, reading things, and listening to her commentary. And that's probably the most annoying thing about the game, is that it feels a little bit like it feels very slow. There's no action, you know? When there is a bit of action, but again, I won't go into that, but it's not an action game, you know? It's not...
Some good dancing going on there.
Yeah, I mean, again...
I have to give the game slight credits for having a poster in the background of a rock band that's called Tenderloin. I just saw it when they were talking earlier. I was like, that's pretty funny.
All the... there's quite a lot of, like, neorealism, you know, that kind of, you know, like GTA-style advertising and ideas.
I love that kind of stuff.
And you've got choices, like here's another choice that's coming up, for example. You've got a choice whether to... That's one thing that happens. Everything drops and you can't hide in the closet anymore, so you have to rewind time in order to move the lamp before you go into the thing. But you're under duress here because her dad's trying to get in the room type thing, you know? I'm not spoiling anything because, you know, this is the kind of thing that would happen in a normal teenager's room, probably, you know, if you don't want your dad to find out that someone's in your room or whatever. But anyway, yes, so... again, if it's your kind of game, I'd definitely go for it. It's very interesting, and
I've been on the fence about it, but I kind of might get it. I don't know.
I'm definitely enjoying it. Not as much as some of the other games I'm playing, but it's still enjoyable.
It's allowing Chris to live out his lifelong dream of being a 13-year-old girl.
I am a 13-year-old girl. I don't need to live the dream. I
just hence the beard.
Put the beard on afterwards, after, you know, when I come on the show.
It's after the beard of training bra he's wearing underneath his t-shirt.
Yes. Okay, so on to the next game. So I've been playing another game, which you will have heard of, and I've got a few admissions to make about this game. The Escapists, which is, again, this is an indie game, and this is a game that I wasn't sure what it was about when I bought it. I just heard a lot of hype about it, and what I had heard, I liked the sound of, but I didn't really know what it was. It's a prison emulator. It's not Prison Architect type emulator. You're not making a prison, but you're in prison, and the whole premise is you need to escape from various different types of prisons. It is insanely difficult. Now, the thing that makes this annoying is that the first level says very easy underneath it when you load it, and it took me 15 hours to get out of the first prison.
Fucking hell.
I lost so many... I didn't have a fucking clue what I was doing. That essentially, you're a prisoner. You have to go... As you can see here, there are favours that you can do for other prisoners, and... you get paid to do those favours, and you have to build up money in order to buy things off other prisoners. You also have to build up your strength, intelligence, and speed in order to learn recipes, or learn, not learn recipes, sorry, in order to put recipes together. So, for example, if you find a battery and a sock, you can combine them and make a battery sock, kind of super sock weapon to hit people with. If you use a sock and a piece of soap, that's just a standard sock mace. There's loads of them, though. If you get two bits of wood and a bit of wire, you can make nunchucks. And these are just the weapons. Now, one thing that the learning curve is literally, I would say, vertical. You need a wiki in order to play it. It's that complicated. There's so many recipes there, and there's so many scenarios in which you can get caught while you try. I mean, it's, you know, I imagine like a real prison. it's quite hard to get out. So if you find so everything's random as well. So all of the items that you have are random. You can buy some items. You can pick steal items out of other people's drawers in their cell. Or you can beat up guards, and as long as you... They all carry keys as well, and as long as you don't take the key off them, they won't put you in solitary. But if you take the key off them and then use a putty mould to make a plastic key, or to make a fake key, and then put the key back on them... This took me ages to figure that out. It's like, put the key back on them, then you can use the key to open a door, but the key, because it's plastic, has a certain durability on it, so you can only use it 5 times or something. So you have to very, very carefully plan your escape. There's a hell of a lot of like prison films and prison literature kind of... nods in there as well. There's a lot of Shawshank Redemption type stuff in there. Like, you have a poster in order to put over the wall once you've dug the wall out. It's very, very easy to, as I said, to get caught. You can't see now, but I've actually got a load of contraband hidden behind a wall near my cell. And you use different bits of contraband, combine them together to make... So, for example, you can't find a pickaxe, but you can make a pickaxe if you've got a crowbar, a bit of wood, a file, and some other things. I can't remember off the top of my head. You also have to conform to a schedule as well. And on the easy prison, they don't really care where you are. I mean, they'll tell you off, but like, you'll only get 10% suspicion if you get caught while you're not doing your job or in the showers at the right time or having a meal at the right time. So you have to follow this whilst trying to do all the favours for people, which are things like knock people out, get a teddy bear for somebody from someone else's room, knock people out in order to get an item from them. You can also disrupt people in order to get their job. So you start off on this level, for example, as in the laundry. So you have to go to the laundry and just move dirty laundry into the washing machine and then into the clean laundry basket. Do that 20 times and you've completed, then you've got free time for the rest of it. So that free time becomes very valuable in that you can now run off and maybe start hacking away at a wall while no one's watching because they're all busy doing the jobs, or start unscrewing a vent or something, or start crafting your weapons or hide it. But as soon as you get caught and put in solitary, every single little bit of progress that you've made to get out is cancelled. So if I got caught now, all of that contraband that you see above, you see a poster that I've got in my room, and then all of that contraband that I've collected will disappear. It's really difficult, and I don't care who you are, it's hard, you know. And I think I'm on the third prison now. Now I've got my head round it, but it's insane. So I'm doing my job right now. And there's also
Is this a British game? Just because somebody said gob earlier, and I was like, Americans don't say shut your gob or whatever it was.
I'm not sure, I have to be honest. There's lots of American style language in there as well, though.
Fair enough. All right, fair enough.
And names. Everything, again, all the names and characters are randomly generated every time you start. But the prison is static. So you have to... there's loads of different ways in and out as well of the prison. There's loads of different ways that you can escape. If you go outside during the day and you've got contraband on you, you might get shot by the guards on the wall. Or if you start...
Carry on.
So if you start cutting a fence in the daytime, you'll get shot and then put in solitary immediately. If you start digging a hole in the ground and a guard sees you digging the hole and your desk isn't over the top of the hole, then you get caught. You can use dirt to refill the hole, but then you have to reuse a pickaxe or a shovel in order to open it again, and then that uses the durability on the shovel. So you have to be very, very careful. You have to really plan what you're doing. The more contraband you build up and the more items that you build, the more risk it is of losing it. And it's like, it's almost like, right, I've spent an hour getting all of this gear together, hiding it, and then accidentally you might forget to put the poster back on the wall, or you might put it back a millisecond too late, just as a guard's passing the front of your cell. But you can also do things like put bed sheets on front of your cell in order for them to not be able to see it. But if they see it, they'll come and take their bed sheets down, but they won't. You'll have a little bit more time to do it. It's really good. It's really hard, but it's really good.
One more question about the prisons. Do they have any like factions or, you know, prisoners who you don't do favors for, but they might be out to shank you or whatever?
Right, so you have for each prisoner, when I mouse over them, you'll see the colour of the name. And they've all got names, obviously, but the colour depicts how... next time I click on one, you'll see a reputation bar as well. The more stuff you do against that prisoner, the less reputation you get with them. So one of my tasks then was to distract people at exercise period. So I did that, and then the guards chased me. So the guards' reputation goes down, and if the guards don't like you, then they'll beat you up more often. If the prisoners don't like you, then they'll just randomly attack you at times. But you can get favour up by giving them items, giving them money, or doing favours for them. So there's a reputation system in the game. Everything, it's quite intricate. There's quite a lot of stuff in it. And you all get naked when you're in the shower, and there's all kinds of like little quotes that go on as well from various, again, prison films, etc. Oh, there's also a bug in the game as well, which I discovered. I've done it in one of my games before. If you walk upwards or downwards, and you just walk straight, you'll walk at a certain speed, but if you walk at an angle, so down and right or down and left, they've added the vectors together instead of multiplied them together, so you go 1.5 times as fast, so you can get away from guards a lot quicker. It's a dead simple change to do. I actually made the mistake, and Lou told me off for it when we were doing the last game jam, but it's interesting. So when people are knocked out as well, you can nick things out of the pockets, but if the guards see you do that, they'll chase you and your reputation will go down with them, and it's good.
Sounds complicated.
It's very complicated, and I don't feel too bad that it took me 15 hours to get out of the first prison, you know, because it's so easy to get caught. But as soon as you figure it out, it's like I've actually now started getting big, massive areas of contraband saved. But the problem is that some of the prisons, there's no area to save contraband. You can't put them in your desk because your desk gets searched occasionally. So you have to dig a hole under your desk. And if you're in the hole, there's no way, unless you fill the hole with dirt, to get for them not to see you, if you know what I mean. So you have to do it at night. If you're sharing a cell with somebody else, they usually grass you up, so you're like, oh, for fuck's sake. And it's all it takes is one little mistake, and if you spend the entire night doing something, your fatigue goes all the way up, so you've knackered for the next day and you have to shower or sleep or eat in order for your fatigue to come down. And if you spend all night doing it, you don't, the game doesn't save. So you have to go to sleep in order for the game to save. So you couldn't even save scum on it, if you know what I mean. If you're doing something all night, which you quite often are, because that's the best time in order to do any digging. Or you can also wear uniforms. Oh, there's loads of stuff. It's insane the amount of stuff in the game. It's wonderful.
If your cellmate grasses up on you, can you give him a good old shanking?
Yep. You don't kill anyone though, you just knock them out.
Just got an obsession with shanking people.
The better.
If you're going to be in prison, I want to stab someone with a knife made out of a melted toothbrush. That's what I want to do constantly.
So if you ever get put in prison for whatever reason, the first thing you're going to do is go in there, melt your toothbrush, combine it with your razor blade, go and shank some people.
Fucking right.
That's exactly what you can do in this as well. You can sharpen your toothbrush on the wall. So the toothbrush and combs are the two items that you don't need any other item in order to create a weapon. So you can make really basic weapons with that. If you've got a razor blade and a comb, you can combine them to... But you can only create certain recipes, whatever you want to call them, item combinations, if your intelligence is high enough, and you get a higher intelligence by either using the internet for some reason, which I think is madness, on the internet is intelligent, or going to the library and reading books. I think there might be other scenarios as well, but I've only done two or three prisons, so when you do escape though, I tell you, the tension when you've decided tonight, I'm going to do it tonight, I'm going, you've got everything ready, and then the amount of times I've done it and then missed one little thing, like I've accidentally forgotten to make a bed dummy, because you make a bed dummy with two pillows and a blanket, and you stick that in your bed so you can not, so they won't notice you. And then you put a guard uniform, there's loads of different ways to escape, put a guard uniform on, hack through some walls, put some fake ceilings and fake wall grates in the, oh, just mental. You can make paper mache and stuff and make, oh, it's brilliant. And to answer Wutt's question in chat, probably, yes, prepares me for real life. But I'm pretty sure that they will be pretty sus of most of the methods that were used in The Escapist. One, because they're in The Escapist, and two, because they're in every film ever. Escape from Alcatraz, Shawshank.
It sounds fun, though. And the publisher was Team 17, so I imagine it is a British game.
There's lots of Team 17 nods in there as well. There's one of the tasks is you have to go and collect a Worms game from somebody. Another one is there's Panarium Barrels. Panarium's another indie game that's been recently published by Team 17. One of my Twitter mates has done the graphics for it, and there must be barrels in the game or something. I haven't played it, unfortunately, but you give them to people and that ups your reputation with them. It's just one of the random, occasional items that you'll get. It's just the quantity, the amount of different items that there are available, and the amount of different recipes. You know, I think there's maybe 20 different recipes, but it takes a while for you to get all the crafting notes to figure out what they are. And that's why I say use a wiki, you know, because at least you'll get there quicker. Might be a bit of cheating, but Jesus Christ. Mm. Okay. Two more games I've played. I've played Dwarf Fortress, but not too much. I'm not going to talk about that any more than I did last time. The Vanishing of Ethan Carter Redux, which I'd already talked about. This is more than two games, by the way. These are just two of the other ones that I haven't got any footage for. I actually completed The Vanishing of Ethan Carter a couple of days after the last show we did. And again, brilliant, lovely looking game, beautiful looking game. A bit annoying at one point because I just couldn't find this. I didn't know that there was this one switch that was behind something that you had to turn in order to advance in the game. And I just spent forever walking around caverns that I'd already been around and nothing was happening. Nothing was going on. And I spent hours and hours and hours. I eventually ended up looking on the internet to go, what do I do? Because what? It's just stopped. The game's just stopped. There's nothing going on. And all it was a switch to open a door or to lower some water or whatever so I could get over it and then finish the game. There was one little bit to do at the end. But again, good game, you know, good story game, and very, very nice looking. So, last two indie games. This War of Mine, which, have you heard of, guys?
I've heard of the game, yeah.
I have, yeah. It does look quite interesting, but very depressing from what I've heard.
Yeah, it's got a very depressing tone to it, and it's very difficult as well to manage. Now, this is quite an advanced version of, like, I've done quite a lot in this game, so there's a lot of icons in my house. But essentially, you spend the day, the daytime, cooped up in your house, managing the food, the hunger, stamina, you know, kind of how tired they are, and the illness of everybody. You need to have medicine and herbs to, and also happiness as well. You have to have medicine and herbs to increase their hunger. But every time, people can just randomly get sick. So if you haven't got enough medicine in, you have to go out and make decisions whether or not you're going to rob an old couple. Happy 2016 corps in chat. In fact, there's a few people chatting in chat. Sorry, we're being very ignorant this week. And nothing's relevant, so I'm going to keep talking about the game. So, obviously there's weapons in the game. There's medicine. There are lots of different crafting recipes and things to do. So you can collect rainwater, for example. Whenever you're out at night, you send one person out. So generally, you might have one person who's got more inventory space than the other ones, or another guy that's really good at military, you know, he's good with guns or something, and another guy that's everything. If you see in the bottom, if you can read it, it says Amelia, talented lawyer. That's their skill. So some of them are relatively useless in a war, but others are like Zlata bolsters spirits, so she can play guitar. So you can sit her down and play guitar during the day. But
do you play as one person, or are you taking control of these different characters?
You're
managing them.
You're managing them all, so you're right. Telling them all what to do. So someone might be getting depressed. So we've just switched into the night. So what happens in the night is you choose somebody to scavenge, one person to go out and scavenge. It's not particularly realistic, this bit, but it is what it is. You, depending on how many beds you've made, you can choose a certain number of people to sleep in a bed. Now, none of my people at the moment have an ailment, so. Or they're not tired, they're not anything. But after the night, if they don't sleep in a bed, they'll sleep on the floor if they're not guarding. If they're guarding, they'll be tired the day after. If they're sleeping on the floor, they'll be kind of half tired. If they're in a bed, they'll usually be quite well, you know, they'll be quite well the day after. But if they get ill, or if they are ill, it's better to put them in a bed so they don't get more ill. Sometimes you just have to make decisions and go, right, I'm going to rob this person, you know, when you're out, or right, I'm going to have to, there's someone's in this house and I'm nicking stuff from them because I'm like, right, I've run out of food. We've got no food in the thing. I've only got one place that I can go to, so I have to make sure I get all of the food. You can stealth around in a level. You can take weapons and armor, but all of that takes up inventory space. So it's a very stressful, you know, stressy, managey game. And
so it looks like, as well, just on the basic terms of the premise of the game, are you in a country that has been invaded by an outside military force? Is that the idea?
you are it's not specified. You're in a country, but it's not a real country. It's certainly a European country of some sort. You can tell by all the names. It feels like a Western, like Hungary or Poland or something like that. That's what it feels like. But it's there's nothing specified. It's not a, you know, it's not no real names are used or real country places. But you have to be careful. It's like wood is really valuable, but wood takes up what two planks of wood take up one inventory slot, whereas you could carry maybe 8 medicine bottles in that one inventory slot. So you're constantly managing your inventory. Plus, where I am right now, there's a sniper that's trying to shoot at me as well. So if I get shot, I'm going to be injured, so I have to be bandaged when I get back home. If I don't bandage myself up, I'll keep bleeding. And if I don't sleep while I'm bandaged, the bandage will be useless. So you have to be careful about who you use and when you use them. Very, very stressful, but also very...
It looks engaging.
It is. And the story's interesting because everyone's got their own story as well. So if you care that much, I wasn't that bothered about the individual biographies. But you read them, but then they... Like, say, for example, you do steal... Like, you go to an old couple's house that is really safe. There's nobody that's going to attack you there. But there's an old couple that's just walking around following you and going, please don't take our medicine. We're going to die without it. And it's like, oh, fucking hell, don't do that to me. It's a game. Lay off with the heavy stuff, you know? But that's the point of this game, is that it is a war zone and you're a civilian in a war zone. And it makes you think about... You know, I think that's what one of the things that critics have said, that it makes you think about the other side of war, you know? But it does it really well. I mean, you have to, there's a guy that sometimes turns up at your house during the day that's selling goods, or trading goods, rather. He doesn't sell, you don't have any money in the game. But so you might trade him some wood if you've got a load of that for some medicine. See, I just got shot then, so when I go back, you can only carry a certain amount of ammo as well, so you can't go on a shooting rampage and... Some of it's a little bit unrealistic, but, you know, you can only carry, I think, 5 bullets in one inventory slot, and it's like, probably carry a bit more than that, couldn't I? You know, I've got a few pockets, but, you know, you are carrying planks of wood and plants, you know, and things like that as well. I really enjoyed it. It's one of those games, it's a permadeath as well. So, that's another thing as well. You have to make decisions based on heat as well. So it's at one point winter comes in. You can turn winter off in the game, so it never comes in. But if winter comes in, you have to then start using wood, which you use to build things in your house, to light the fire. And you can use wood to cook things, or you can use, you know, other kind of thing, other things to burn as well. It is very stressful when I think back at it.
Is there like a narrative? Is there is there an ending in sight, or is it just that you keep doing various
yes.
tasks?
The first time I played it on all the default settings, and I just went with it. Why is it paused? Right. So the first time I played it, I played everything default, and I just went with it. And I think I got to maybe day 6 or 7, and my main guy died, and then everyone died of hunger because I didn't have a guy to go out, and because everyone was already ill, and yeah, I didn't manage it properly. The second time I played it with a load of custom settings, and I chose 4 people, and 4 people with very specific skills, and I turned the winter off, and I did various other things so I could play it, and I played it through. Or you can lower the amount of days it takes for the ceasefire to occur as well. So essentially, there are 30 days or 40 days or whatever. I think it might be randomly set between a certain number when you... but each day is quite hard. You really do have to be careful about the decisions you make. Because even making beds, you can't make a bed unless you've got the resources to make your bed. And you have to have beds in order for certain people to get better. Some people will turn up at your door. An old guy might turn up at your door who might be really, really good at cooking. So he'll take less resources when he cooks, but he'll be ill when he turns up. So you have to get him better before you can use him to cook. And you can set rat traps as well in order to get more things. You can set rainwater catchers and stuff, but each of those use additional other resources. Like, you have to create rain filters in order to get water, which is created from materials and wood, which is also needed to make weapons and ammo, and you have to build different stations, you know, it again, very complicated. This is what I mean about indie games these days, that we really are in a golden age where there's so much effort being put into the intricacies of the systems within the games. It's really, really interesting. To answer Wutt's question, could you murder the old people for food? Yes, but you don't need to. You could if you want. You could go in and shoot them, but you'd be wasting ammo because they do nothing. But again, every time I've played the game, that house has been slightly different. I think there's a few flags on each of the locations that say if it's aggressive or passive, what kind of people are there. So you might have the same house the next game you play where you've got two old people, but you've also got the son there who will fight you off if you turn up. But you can stealth around the level, or you can shoot him if you've got the weapons for it. Lots of options. Lots and lots of options. Alcohol and cigarettes are really, you know, really expensive, and they can be used for trading, but only in certain times of war as well. At different times within the war, different commodities are more expensive than others. So cigarettes might be in hard supply at the beginning, but then if you start building up supply of them, you can have a radio, and the radio will tell you, cigarettes are no longer in hard supply, we need diamonds now or something, you know, whatever. Because diamonds are really hard to come by in war as well.
Blood diamonds, obviously.
Oh, I didn't understand Wutt's question properly. He didn't phrase it properly, but he said, could you murder the old people for food? So, could you become a cannibal?
Cannibal, yeah.
Right. No, I didn't mean that. You can murder them to get their food without any aggro, yes. But you can't eat them. But that is a good idea. They should maybe have implemented that. Maybe that's a bit too dark, considering it's...
If you're going for a sense of verisimilitude, then you might as well chuck cannibalism into the mix as well.
Yeah.
Which is what this game looks like it's sort of going for, with the photographs of the people as well, who look like photographs of people rather than computer-generated models.
They
right?
are actual yeah. people, yeah, yeah. Actual.
Probably faces. They're game developers, most of them.
Maybe. Either that, or it's just, you know, actors that they've got to take photos of. And...
Yeah.
But, yeah. So, yes.
It does look like an intriguing game, but it's one of those games that might be very engaging, but I don't know if it's in. Is it enjoyable? Yeah. I know fun is a weird thing to talk about with a game like this, but is it an enjoyable experience?
I thoroughly enjoyed it. It's very micromanagey, and once you understand the systems and you get your head around how each of the systems work, then yes, it is enjoyable. Before that, it's again like the Escapist. It's like it's a learning curve like that, but you learn within maybe one or two games. I've only played three or four games, and I've completed it twice out of those three and four. Sometimes someone will go out and get shot, you know, and you'll be, and that's it, they're dead. But you can go back out and collect all the stuff that they got. But you have to make a call as well where you go every night. It's not just about where's safe and where isn't safe. It's more about, is there any food in that location because we really need food? Is there any wood because we're getting really cold at home? I need to make another bed, so I'm going to need some components and wood in order to do it. And I haven't got any because I've used them on something else. And it's very... That's the stressful part of it, you know? I liked it, though. I like it, and I will definitely be playing it a bit more. But got said, my last indie game that I'm going to be talking about just now, and I've only been playing this over the last 2 days. You may have heard of it. I heard of it because one of the guys that I follow on YouTube is playing it. It's Kingdom. Have you heard of it?
No.
So it's a really, really simple looking game, and it's really, especially when you first start playing it, it just feels a little bit, what is going on here? What am I doing? The premise is you build a kingdom. You collect little coins, which you can see me picking up and dropping. Yeah. And you spend coins in order to expand. But again, you have to manage those coins. So, obviously, the more advanced it becomes, the more coins you get and the more buildings you can make. But you start off and you have to give people, these little guys walking around, you give them one coin in order to recruit them, essentially, for them to come into your kingdom. You then spend coins to either make them a bowman or a engineer or a hammer guy, but you've only got a certain amount of coins to do it every day. The more the mistake I made, I think this is the game I made plenty of mistakes in, so anyone who has played it is probably going to laugh at what I'm doing, but this is the first time I played it. I think you make barricades and then you make towers for the archers to stand in, but you also need to send the archers out, or this is all autonomous as well, they all kind of do it once you've paid them, and you tell them to build this and they'll eventually come and build it. But you have to be careful, because if you tell someone to build something before you've got enough defences in place and nighttime comes, they'll get killed, or they'll get they get the coin stolen off them and they end up wandering back to a camp out in the wilderness somewhere, so they'll bugger off. But it's again, at nighttime, don't go out, because there's all these demon things, like little witchy, no, I don't even know what they are, the little interdimensional things that come out of a gate somewhere. So it's a little bit slow at the start, so let's move it on a little bit. There we go, there's one of the little guys fighting, attacking one of my barricades. The archers are the worst shot on the planet. They can't hit shit, I swear to God. So you need about 10 or 20 archers in order for it to make any sense. So every day you get a little chest that has a certain amount of coins in them, but you can also like make farms, and the farms give you more coins. You can send out your archers out. Well, I said they'll do it automatically if they don't have a tower to sit in, but the archers will go out and get and hunt, so they'll get coins from deer and from rabbits, things like that. But the little guys that come at night, they will steal your gold. And so if, for example, you don't have any barricades, or all your barricades get knocked down because some of the enemies are ridiculous, toward day 20 or 30, you're getting trolls and all kinds of things coming to knock your stuff down.
Bloody trolls.
Oh, they're a bastard. But that's the problem, is what I've done right now on the screen is I've told them to build four barricades, but I don't have enough hammerers or enough engineers to build the barricades before nighttime. So my base just gets overwhelmed by enemies, because once you set them to build, the structure gets destroyed, and then the next level of the structure starts getting built. So again, it's a bit of a learning curve in order to figure out when you should really set people off. You have to knock trees down in order to expand outwards as well. You have to upgrade your central camp, which is your campfire in the middle, in order to be able to build bigger buildings. You have to also go out into the wilderness to like give money to shrines and various other buildings in order to get the more advanced buildings as well. I think today I got up to maybe day 35, maybe a bit further than that. But I said you can build farms to make more money, but in order to build a farm, they need to be defended, for one, and you need to have a certain upgrade so you can actually make farmers as well from you guys. So you have to manage it. You have to go out to camps and recruit more people before you can build more structures in order to populate those structures with archers, in order to defend farms, in order to go out and get more people. And it's a permadeath thing as well. So say you've got 8 gold coins on you. You've got 8 hits. After the 8th hit, you get hit again and your crown falls off, and the little dudes, the little enemies, will just grab your coin and that's it. Grab your throat. Oh my God. After you've got no coins left, your crown falls off, and then they grab your crown and that's it, game over immediately. So the last game that I played, I ran all the way to the edge of the map. I had got a massive base. I didn't have any coins on me because I was an idiot and I forgot, and got stuck at the edge of the map. And then nighttime came, and about 300 of these little things just came out of the gate and just descended on me. And it's like all it took was one, because I had no coins on me, and they all took my crown, and that was it. Game over. Without just one little mistake that I made, I was out for too long at night. And you can look at how far through the day out you are by the sun and the moon at night, etc.
So it follows the Sonic the Hedgehog model of blink gives you hell.
Yeah. Well, no, because you no, because your coins are used to build primarily. But if you've got loads of coins, then you've got more of a chance of not being killed immediately, you know?
But if you've got, like, loads of... Say you're, that little bag in the top left corner is full, can you just take loads of hits off the goblins or whatever?
Yes, but if... By the time that bag will be full, if your bag's full as well and you get more coins, it'll overflow and they'll just fall into the water at the front. So you're wasting coins at that point. But if you get to a point where your bag is full, there's going to be quite a lot of enemies by that point, because it's quite hard to get to that point. You know, it's not hard, it's takes a while to get to that point. And if there's, say there's 20 enemies heading towards you, they all hit you, so they don't just run past you. There's no way you can jump over them or kill them or defend yourself or anything. If there's an enemy there, it's going to hit you. If it's between you and where you want to go, put it that way. So if you've got one enemy in front of you and you've got 3 coins, you can get past it. But if you've got 30 coins and it becomes nighttime, there's no way you're going to get home. It's just not. You have to be very careful about when you go out. But it's a really cool game. And again, it's another one that's got a fairly simple system in it. It's very easy to pick it up and learn. But... again, takes a little bit to master. It takes a little bit to figure out exactly how to play it properly. So yeah, there's a little guy in a turret there. But again, another recommended game. I would definitely recommend that one. So that's me.
Just the usual 6,000 games.
Yeah, I've not played much this week.
This month. That's like a solid hour worth of you talking about games you've played.
Sorry, but you know, just because you guys haven't played anything, not my fault.
What's that thing that you have to keep doing, Sam? What's it called? Going to work.
I do have a job that I have to attend every now and then.
Yeah, but you know,
they get a bit angry if you keep not coming in and not telling them why. They just don't like.
Yeah, like once or twice you can normally get away with it, but.
I was just bloody nagging about that.
You'd think I was on the dole the amount you two go on, right? Not claiming off the state. Anyway, so shall we move on? We were gonna talk about the most anticipated games of 2016, but we are running very, very late. So shall we just do a few of the news articles that we've got and maybe move them on to next week?
Yeah, go for it, man.
Is there anything in particular that you guys are interested in? Because I said I've been doing a lot of talking.
Sam, go ahead.
No, you go first, it's alright.
I was just going to say that I'm very interested in XCOM 2, which is coming out on Friday.
February the 5th, isn't it?
Yeah. Hopefully I'll be able to put a few hours towards this game and not actually just put it in my Steam library and never actually start it. But I'm looking forward to it. I have looked at a few early reviews. Not read in depth, but just kind of scanned over them. It does seem quite positive. I am looking for a good strategy.
Yeah, I said if you want a good strategy, go for that Druid's Duel thing. It's not quite XCOM standard, but it's still a great strategy game. I'm looking forward to it too, but I don't know if I'm going to get it on release. I'll see. I don't know.
I've got it. I know we complain about this, but I've actually got it pre-ordered. But I don't know. I did only pre-order it last week.
It doesn't matter. You still pre-ordered.
Oh, the game was finished. The game was finished months ago.
Ah, it's not about that. It's about sticking it to the man. That's what it's about.
Fighting the power.
I am also looking forward to XCOM 2. Don't know. I want to get it on release, but I don't know. I get a bit twitchy at spending full price on a game or even close to full price.
I didn't pay full price for it.
No, but you know what I mean. It's still not going to be. It's going to be still at least 20 quid, isn't it?
Yeah.
So yeah.
Yeah, but again, you've got to kind of quantify that as to the amount of enjoyment that you get out of it.
£20 for a full game that's newly released is fucking cheap.
Well, it is. PC games are a lot cheaper, though, aren't they? We've talked about
120 hours on the last XCOM.
Really? Wow. Yeah. I only put 44 into it, and I thought that was a lot. How did you put 120 into it? Have you played it through a few times?
Yeah, I played it on Iron Man mode.
Was it you that was underwhelmed with it, or was that like Lou or somebody who was saying that they couldn't really get into it?
That was Lou, but I don't think he really tried, to be honest.
Well, I'll tell you what, let's see. Let's see how many hours Lou played on it, just to...
45 minutes.
0.8 hours.
Yeah, so he spent like 40 minutes playing. He'll have barely set up his base.
Yeah, he didn't give it any chance. He's just not playing games, is he? Let's just admit it. He's not... Admit it for him. I was going to say, I played Enemy Unknown all the way through, and then I played Enemy Within all the way through. So, what, 22 hours per game? And I played a bit of multiplayer with you, Steve, but we had problems with it, didn't we?
We did have problems with that, yeah. Did you ever play the Long War?
What was that? Enemy Unknown? I thought that was before that. No, I thought it was the old XCOM. I know that. But I thought it was a mod for the previous XCOM.
There might have been a mod for the original as well, but there's a mod for this remake. And again, that adds in extended technology trees, more characters, more missions, that type of thing. So you can get a really long game going out of that.
Yeah. Well, I did. I mean, I love it. It's brilliant. But no, I don't think I did play it. There's a few questions in chat I was just going to answer. Who's played the Division beta? Anybody? No?
It's one of those games that I kind of... If it comes out and it's really good, then cool. But I'm... I think it might be a little bit generic and shit. And I think it talks a big game. I don't know how much it's going to deliver. That's all I'm thinking.
I signed... Well, it's Ubisoft, so fuck it in my eyes. I signed up for the beta. Because I didn't pre-order it, I'm not guaranteed... Well, I wasn't guaranteed to get it, and they sent an email out saying, sorry, if you haven't pre-ordered, you're not going to play it. So they just wanted more email addresses, basically. I don't know, it's been getting all right reviews. The one problem that has been... when's the game out? We've got a list. We've got a thing on here. Closed beta is 28th, 29th of January, which has passed. But there has been rampant cheating on the beta as well, which I think is a really shitty kind of state of affairs. But at the same time, it is a big AAA game, and this is a AAA game. It's had millions spent on it. It's going to look very, very nice, and I imagine it's going to be very multiplayer focused as well.
Yeah.
So I probably won't even bother with it, I have to be honest. Probably not.
Probably.
It's not on my radar of things I give a shit about, let's put it that way.
No. In response to Corpse's Where's Lou? Lou is no longer doing the show with us. He did.
He replied with
he's dead. Lou is no longer doing the show with us because he doesn't play any games whatsoever. He's even worse than Steve is. And he's blaming it all on the fact that Fallout 4 wouldn't let him play left-handed, but it's because he's got a girlfriend and he can't be bothered to turn up and play games and contribute anymore. But anyway, so Lou's no longer joining us, but he may come back on the show if I let him, which is very unlikely, to be fair.
If he plays a game that he likes, he might want to come on and talk about that for a bit.
Nah, he won't.
He won't play a game he likes.
You know what he's like anyway.
Like a game now.
Like a good old whinge, wouldn't he? Doesn't he? I was going to talk about the Division, but I said I don't know. I don't know if I'm going to bother. I mean, I keep saying that I'm going to try and get that last Ubisoft failure. Not Assassin's Creed.
Watch Dogs.
Again, I think it's like £7 on Steam now or something, Watch Dogs. Yes. And I still can't be arsed with it.
That's $23.99.
All right, well, it was at some point £7. It was in some sale and it was very, very cheap. And I looked at it and I thought, no. Yeah. Just don't think I can be arsed.
The premise of Watch Dogs is very, very weak and flimsy anyway. My niece died, so now I feel fine about killing whoever the fuck I want to avenge her.
Oh, is that what it is?
That's basically the plot of Watch Dogs.
Okay, so a couple of VR articles. HTC Vive pre-orders went live on February the 29th. However, I can't find a link to it anywhere. I've been looking today to see if I can find the pre-order link and prices and things like that, but I can't see it anywhere. We've obviously now got the Oculus prices, which is, what, 600 quid, was it? Was it six? You went on the show, Steve, actually. They announced it a few weeks ago.
Oh, yeah, it was...
Was it 600 quid?
Was it around that? Do you know what? I've forgotten, I'll be honest with you. I've got five in my head for some reason.
It'll be in a previous document, but either way, it was a lot more than 300 quid, which is what we thought it might be, and even that was pushing it. So I reckon the HTC Vive is going to be roughly the same. PlayStation VR is apparently cheaper than that. That's coming out at like 350, I think, but you have to have a Wii-size box for it. In order to get it working with the PlayStation, because the PlayStation 4 is not powerful enough to run it on its own. This is just a bit of clickbait, so I'm not going to post the link anyway, but Palmer Luckey states that PlayStation VR is not as high-end as Oculus. So this, it's a bit of a dig, but at the same time, PlayStation have also, Sony rather, have also admitted that it's not aimed at the same market in the slightest. I mean, Oculus is going to be a lot higher, you know, lot higher quality in general, whereas PlayStation VR is going to be cheaper and it's going to be more kind of mass marketed, I think, at people. Couple of other, that's it in terms of VR. Oh, one big bit of news, indie game news that I was excited about. The Witness came out on January the 26th. It's been getting rave reviews. It looks beautiful.
It does look very good.
And I can't wait to play it, but I've just been trying to finish, you know, at least play some of my other indie games before I get it. And plus, it might be on a sale at some point. So I'm going to leave it for a little bit. I'm not in a major rush to play it, but I do really, really, really want to play The Witness.
I've not heard of that, and I don't think I looked at that article. What is it?
So The Witness is a... Do you remember the indie game, The Movie?
Yes.
Do you know Jonathan Blow, the guy that did Braid on that?
Braid, yeah.
It's his new game, and he's put all of his money that he made from Braid into it, and plus a lot more. And it's basically a puzzle game set in an island. I say basically, apparently it's a little bit more than that. There's a lot more to it. The puzzles are a lot more cerebral than you would expect from a normal puzzle game. I don't know, because I haven't played it, and I can't really comment much, but it sounds cool, and it sounds very much like a... It sounds actually quite Talos Principle-y, quite...
Yeah, I thought that.
It feels like you're all in one place, and you're kind of in a hub that you have to go to different areas and solve puzzles in order to unlock something at the end. I don't know. I haven't, because I want to play it and I know it's going to be pretty good, I haven't really done much research on it. So that's Biggs has commented on the chat. The Witness is great. There's parts that blow my mind. So Biggs has actually played it. In a how the fuck did he even program that kind of way, which sounds awesome.
It does actually.
So yeah, don't spoil it anymore for me, Biggs, but yeah, that's made me even more excited about it. Right, so there's some other big news from probably about a month ago now. Psychonauts 2. Now, has anybody here played Psychonauts 1?
No, I've heard it's really good, though.
Yeah, Psychonaut is some apparently in this anyway. It's Double Fine's first game. I think it's their first game anyway, or at least one of the first games. Anyway, it was a crowdfunded game from a while back, and it was. I think it was crowdfunded via Kickstarter, and they reached the goal and exceeded it and got loads of money. Double Fine are well known for not spending all of the money in the right places, or fans believe that they should not spending it in the right place. And Tim Schafer can be a little bit of a spendthrift with the money. But I mean, they've failed to deliver on a few of their promises. But generally, from my experience, they've delivered the games. I mean, I don't follow on that carefully. But there's also been a guy that's put a video together saying that this new Psychonauts 2 has been crowdfunded via a new platform called Fig. And Fig is basically owned by Double Fine. Not directly, but via lots of parent companies. And the way that Fig works is that you crowdfund a game and you essentially get a share in the profit of that game, or a share in the or a share of that game, whether it's profit or not, you get a share of that game. Now, the way that it works is quite convoluted and quite underhanded as well. I'm going to post a video link in chat, and you can have a look at it in your own time, make your own mind up. But the guy who he's went into some quite a lot of detail about the finances and the funds and the details behind it. But basically, the message is be careful about funding anything on FIG if you think you're going to get your money back, because it's more likely than not that they'll get the money, spend it on the game, they'll put the game out there, but in terms of the company that you're investing in, unless FIG expands and changes its rules, will disappear at some point. And all of the way that it's been written is essentially you won't have any shares whatsoever in that game, and any money that you think you're investing is probably just going to go up in smoke, essentially. So I'll post that in there, but have a read of it, have a look, and just be careful about those of you who do enjoy your crowdfunding. Considering that FIG, I think only at the moment, only has Psychonauts 2 on it, and they had $3.8 million raised for this game, and under the premise that each of the people are getting a share in the game, but they're probably not getting a share in the game. Okay, moving on. Amazon apparently are going to be selling all of the VR headsets, which is interesting. I thought some of them would be proprietary and, you know, only sold by certain vendors, or the Vive through Steam, for example. I thought they might be selling it, but Amazon are going to be selling them, which is cool. Good news.
Doesn't surprise me. I kind of expected that, to be honest.
I'm going to post a link for this one in chat channel, because this is probably more important than all of the other news put together. Nvidia GPU bug may reveal your secret porn habit. Again, this is a little bit of
secret.
Yeah, a little bit of clickbait. It's essentially what's happening, without rereading the article, from what I understand, is the last video that you watched can be in Chrome, I think, or in certain browsers. The buffer isn't cleared on your Nvidia GPU. So if you do something like a screen share or something that might use the same video buffer, or maybe even on your lock screen on Windows, you might see the last. It might actually show the last frame of the last video that you watched. Doesn't bother me in the slightest, you know. I don't watch porn. It's a disgusting habit, but you know, it's important to some of you out there who care. There's some horror story in there about some grandma seeing it or something like that. I also heard some news on the radio the other day. It was on Radio 2. Somebody at a funeral. I can't remember if it was an old person or a younger person's funeral. Something out there anyway. Someone had accidentally, or they said that they got hacked, but one of the screens that they were showing videos of the person's life and things, someone put some porn on it at a funeral, and everyone was absolutely horrified. The vicar was on the radio having, you know, talking about it and saying it was a complete mistake. It's brilliant. No, it's probably not funny. I probably shouldn't be laughing about that, but you know.
It's one of those things
that happen at my funeral.
I'd probably make that happen at my funeral from the grave. There's only going to be me at my funeral anyway, to be fair, so I'm not bothered. Right. Have you guys heard about the Fine Brothers?
Yeah.
I haven't.
This has been blowing up on the internet.
It's been all over Reddit and Vought and everything for the past few days. It's just.
Yeah. It's kind of funny, like, because for those of you that don't know who the Fine Brothers are, they are these guys have a YouTube channel, or maybe a couple of YouTube channels at this point, because people tend to get more channels as they get bigger and shit. But they basically do these react videos with, like, it's literally like elders react to Frozen, and they'll show some old people sat in a room looking at a screen, and they'll have the screen of, like, say, Frozen in the corner, and the old people will be like, oh, look at the things happening there. That's basically their entire format is that. The story, Chris, do you want to explain it?
No, go ahead if you know the story.
Basically, they brought this video out saying that they were trying to expand and make this thing called React World, which is, as they framed it in the video, was a way for them to get other YouTubers and other people out there to do their own sort of react video formats, and to join in with them and their get they would take a slice of their views that they get, but they would also promote them and give them more views. They would give them these kind of appetites and give them these kind of perks and benefits. Now, the undercurrent of that that everybody immediately picked up on was that they were trying to copyright the idea of making a reaction video at all. Like, they tried to copyright the claims for a video that has React in the fucking title. Now, reacting to stuff is not something you can copyright. It's literally people sat there going, ooh, ah, like, you can't fucking copyright that. And the internet has roundly told them so. And yep. They have basically, according to this article, retracted these copyright claims and rethought their whole business model.
Copyright and trademark claims as well.
Yeah, they were going to go forward with this as a new business venture to expand their thing that they do. And it's just, they just had to like shut it down basically because everyone went, fuck you. And they had like 14 million subscribers and they lost about a million in like 2 days.
Oh, I thought, I saw an article that said they lost 150,000, but that could have been over 15 minutes or something. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah, that's basically what I heard as well, but you put it in a much more articulate way than I would have done. Yeah, they were trying to trademark. Remember, there's a difference between trademark and copyright.
Sorry.
They were trying to trademark React as a word in content titles, and trying to trademark children React and elders React and some other words as well. Some other, not React, but something else to do with this React world thing. They did that at the same time as apparently. They are one of the few contributors on YouTube that have the facility to automatically bring videos down, like, without YouTube's intervention. So they have the facility to say, that video is violating my copyright, I'm going to take it down. And apparently what they've done is, previously, they've taken things down that disagree, you know, that disagree with something that they say or do, not necessarily... They've been abusing that power. And so this is another thing on top of that that's started to make people go, right, well, hang on.
They've had some shady business practices, or at least shady... what's the word I'm looking for here? Things that just seem a little bit morally off. As in, they obviously monetize their videos... And this is something. This is how I heard about the Fine Brothers in the first place. Was a couple of years ago, there was a guy whose animations that I quite like did a cartoon about them, taking the piss out of them, and just said that, oh, you know, they've got no ideas. All they do is do people reacting to stuff. It's lowest common denominator entertainment, which it is. I'm not saying there's anything particularly wrong with it, but that is what they do. But there's a couple of times they did this. Apparently, they do people reacting to, like, a school shooting video. But they monetized that and put advertisements on it and made profit off it. So even though they might be going, oh, we're trying to make a document of a historical, you know, people's reaction, because their angle was, oh, we're trying to make what do people at the time think about this incident, and it could be a historical thing that this is what people were like in 2013 or whatever year it was that it happened. But they profited from that. It's just weird. It's a weird, kind of shady, unpleasant thing to do.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, they think, God, we're going to do this video as an important historical thing and donate money to some cause that's to do with getting guns off the streets or whatever. Do you know what I mean? Like, that kind of thing. You could kind of understand, but they didn't, apparently. This is like a thing that known that they did.
I mean, I didn't want to talk about this for too long because it's not particularly gaming related, but, I mean, I'm sure there's been some reactor videos in the gaming world, so, you know... Steve reacting to Fear 3, for example. Was it Fear 3 with the corridor?
That was the original Fear.
Was it the original?
I think they've done... that in their wheelhouse, they will have had Kids Reactor X game, weren't they? Kids Reactor, the original Mario Brothers. Oh, it looks shit!
But anyway, that seems to have come to a head now, and it seems to... The internet's still very angry about it, but, you know, they've backed down and they've issued an apology, and apparently some... fairly condescending videos they've put up as well that the people aren't agreeing that don't like. But anyway, let's move on.
We're over that story. It doesn't matter. We'll finish with it.
Twitch plays Punch Club, beat in 36 hours with 70,000 participants, and it went on sale on Steam. Now, this is an indie game, Punch Club, where you're... It's like an escapist type thing where you're in a gym and you're training to be a boxer, I believe, and there's all, you know, the finance management and everything else to do with it. I don't know. I don't know that much about it. But the interesting thing about this particular thing is that the game was beat in 36 hours before it was released. And then because it got beat within a certain time period, the developer released it early on, I think it was a full release on Steam, which I thought was pretty cool that they did it that way. It's a nice way of getting some marketing for an indie company. More innovation, more kind of different ideas from the indie community, and I kind of liked it. It was a while back, so I don't know too much more about it, but it was interesting. I'm not sure. I can't remember if I put this in here or not, or it was someone else. It might have been Steve.
I think I put that in there.
PC gamers destroy, in inverted commas, console gamers on cross-platform trials. So I think you put it in, Steve. So can you remember much about this one?
Yeah, it was basically with Microsoft trailing a bit on the console war this time. I think they were trying to...
trailing a bit.
Well, I still think they're selling quite a few units, aren't they?
They're getting trounced by PS4. I mean, PS4's on... last time I looked, I think it was 37 million versus 5 million or something.
Right.
Something
Jesus,
like that.
Jesus, that's ridiculous.
Yeah, it's... I don't... Please don't quote me the figures. Sorry, don't take them as full-on quotes, but I think that was something like that, anyway.
Well, anyway. Yeah, so they ran a series of trials where they basically pitted people on consoles against people playing on PCs. Which ended up in the PC gamers trouncing the console gamers, and then they tried with moderate PC gamers playing the best console gamers, and the moderate PC gamers trounced the console gamers again.
Obviously. Good old PC elitism.
They decided to cancel the project because it would never be viable, they said.
If it's not competitive, if it's co-op, and it's not like a... You know, you have to have instant reactions in order to do something. I think it's fine. Portal 2, I imagine, was a good cross-platform game. Because, I mean, we never did it, Sam, but I really wanted to try and play that with you at some point.
Yeah, it would have been interesting. I've played through quite a lot of the Portal 2 co-op with my sister, actually. We've got... Right. I don't know how long it is, but we've played through a lot of levels of it, and it's very good. It is very good. But that it depends on the kind of game, doesn't it, really? I think in that article, the games... They just suggested, I think there was two games they said. One of them was Gears of War, and one of them was a first-person shooter of some kind. So, yes, in those kind of situations, I don't think it's anybody... I don't think they even need to research the fact that a PC gamer is going to do better at those things.
Well, it's
pretty
it's
obvious,
one of these
isn't
things
it?
Where it's been talked about a lot, and PC gamers have always kind of taken the high ground on this, but I don't think it's ever actually been proven out in a big trial.
Okay.
I mean, it's one of those things that you could argue that console gamers maybe needed... I mean, I get beaten by console gamers when I play on a console, you know, on even grounds, because I'm not used to the control system. But you could argue that console gamers have evolved and have become more proficient at console gaming, so it was worth doing a trial, if you know what I mean, to see if it's changed anything. You know, it is actually viable now, but if it's not, I don't mind. I don't feel like I'm missing out too much.
Yeah.
Well, it's something that we've mentioned before, the cross-platforming idea. I think it depends on the kind of game. If it's a game that doesn't require those, like, accuracy, quick reaction kind of games, like a shooter, there's stuff you could do with it, isn't there? Not all games have to be quick shooters. Anyway.
I think that as a general rule, consoles do driving/racing games better.
I used to like third-person games more on console, but I've actually taken that back recently with playing quite a few, like The Witcher 3 and Metal Gear Solid 5. I actually think I prefer playing them with the mouse, you know, control for the camera. But yeah. Okay, so... What else have we got? We've got a couple more articles, and then we can leave you guys for the night. Yeah, still fairly old news now, but Arkham Knight received a PC patch on the 19th of January that fixes even more issues, and it still has not yet addressed the multi-GPU problem, but they're getting close to it, apparently. I haven't actually tried it. I've put it in my favourites list in Steam in order to remind me to play it at some point, because it's a wonderful game and it's got really good reviews on consoles. But I've just been indie addicted. And the last article we have is Nintendo launches first smartphone app.
Yeah, so I put that in there just because I was looking up things and I thought it was just an interesting little tidbit. Basically, it's a version of Pokemon. The idea of obviously it integrates like social media stuff in there as well. The trailer for it is kind of one of those trailers that makes it seem like you can go out into the real world and catch Pokemon with your phone. Maybe there is some sort of like locational thing where you might be out in a pub and it'll be like, oh, there's a Charizard in this area and you catch it because you're there.
So you fling your mobile phone across the bar.
Yeah, exactly. Like, Pikachu, I choose you. And you just throw your phone against the wall and it breaks and you're like, oh yeah, I'm not actually Ash Ketchum, am I?
Well, you know that Nintendo purchased a big smartphone or a big phone company or smartphone developer company, I can't remember the name of it, NX or something like that. We had it in the news a while back, and that was last year, so this is probably a repercussion of that.
Well, but I think the point of the significance of the article is that it's Nintendo's first foray into this field. It doesn't matter that it's Pokemon or what the game is, really. The fact is that they're now getting into that market, whereas they hadn't done up until this point, almost surprisingly so, because their like handheld stuff is all about that social media interaction, go out in the world and rub your Nintendo DSs against each other and get some stuff from each other or whatever it is that you do, get your Link amiibo and spat that on somebody's thing a bit, but it seems like that would be their natural thing for them to do, and now they've started doing it, so it's just interesting to me. That's
it. Was Dena, and they DENA, and they were mobile services, in-app purchases and user acquisition company, and that was before March last year. So yeah, we were talking about it, and it was an interesting thing at the time because we were like, they don't do mobile, they do, you know, they do handheld consoles, but that's about it. But this is, I think, you know, this is definitely, I don't know, they need to, don't they? They need to get into that market of some sort. I mean, Sony's already got Sony's already in that market, and Sony even sells their own version of smartphones, hardware, etc.
Yeah.
Okay.
Not to mention that a lot of the big games, like your Fallout 4, for example, had a phone app sort of tie-in game, didn't it? So it's something that we could be pretty accustomed to now.
Well, the other
big franchises to have their
Fallout 4 had a tie-in game and a companion app as well. On top of that, and GTA 5 also had a companion app, which was awful. feed Butch the dog and rub his balls and stuff.
Oh god, basically. Yeah.
I got it on my laptop just to have a go of it on the Windows Store, but it took a while for it to come out on Windows or Android. It was out on iOS first. Anyway, so thank you very much to everybody. Unless there's anything you two want to say, anything else that we've missed.
No.
So. Thank you very much, everybody, for watching the show today. And thanks to those who have contributed. We've had quite a lot of chat going on in the room. And sorry for not giving you too much feedback, but we've had a lot to try and get through. We're 20 minutes late, unfortunately. But we're all done now. So thank you very much, everybody. And we'll see you maybe next week, maybe the week after.
Next time.
Next time. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.